But other than that, it's lovely up here, and I did import it.
See, I can't see them, too. Even though they're played to be the name. I don't disagree. I assume there's still people.
Yes.
But I contend they should be started.
Traffic is pretty good.
They know.
I can travel in Ashford Dunwoody Road.
Yeah, in a way, if we can offer that.
Why should I want to use it? It's not too bad much of a way. It would be an extra connector. The connector from through Lake Herman. I came up with a music.
Let's be in the front row.
Thank you all for coming tonight. Everybody take their seats. I will tell you that earlier today the air conditioner was broken in this facility. They called us and I think they fixed it, but I think the lower you sit the cooler it is. So the higher you go the more hot it's going to be up there. And the cheap seats. Is that Father Harmon? Would you like to do the invitation, Father?
Sure. Welcome to Marist. I really apologize about the air. It did all of a sudden break this afternoon, and we haven't had a chance to have the company come in to fix it yet, so we apologize. So I haven't prepared anything, so let's just pause for a moment and ask God to bless us, bless our community. Mighty God, we give you thanks for the many blessings which you have given to all of us. We ask you to bless all those who serve us in Brookhaven. We remember those who lead us. We remember those who provide for us our safety, services for safety and protection, for our well-being. We thank you for the opportunity of coming together to be able to share information and hear one another on various issues facing our community. Ask you always to bless us and all those who come with us and share in our sense of excitement for being a city community. So we ask all of this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Just briefly, I know it's warm, so we'll try and get this done as quick as possible. Thank you all for coming to this mid-year update for the City of Brookhaven, this town hall. I'm glad you all come and look at some of the displays outside that detail where your parks improvements are going to be, your sidewalk new construction and repair is going to be, where your paving is going to be happening this summer. all this happening this summer, and the traffic and corridor studies to make certain that traffic issues are assessed and dealt with. We've already started with that with the improvement at Ashford Dunwoody we did last fall, but we have more to do, and that's another chart that you can ask us about. We have Public Works here, Bennett White's here to talk about any of those issues. We'll also be talking about the North Fork Greenway project. That's, if you don't know what familiar with that is the project down on Beaufort Highway along the North Fork of Peachtree Creek, which sits behind the car wash, the Pink Pony, all the businesses along the southern side or eastern side of Beaufort Highway. We've got a park started there, a trail, a linear park, and it's going to be developed out. We're going to be working with some of the property owners to get easements and do that, but it'll be a great 2.5 mile asset once it's done, and we'll hopefully we have some activities down there like canoeing and kayaking and walking and things of that nature. We'll also be talking tonight, Chief Anduras here to talk, give us a police update. So any questions you have about Neighborhood Watch, about the vacation program, where you can have the police come check on your house when you're gone, or any other issues, or have the police come to your neighborhood to speak, he can address those issues, and maybe we'll have some stats as well. And parks update with Jerry Kinsey, and he has some more staff here. So any questions you have about park improvements, things you want to see, things you don't want to see, we've got a lot going on right now. So make sure you have your opinions heard on that and things you'd like to see in the future in our parks. And then we have a community development update with Ben Song here. He's the head of our community development department. Any zoning issues that you might want to talk about, permitting, code issues, he'll be able to answer those questions. And again, Public Works with Bennett White. And then we'll talk, and then Carl Stevens will talk about our millage rate. As you know, in Brookhaven, we have our separate millage rate that is used to pay for the services of the city. We're limited by charter to a 3.35 millage rate. And for the past 2 years, we've reduced our millage rate successively to 2.85 and to 2.795. And maybe it gets reduced a little bit more this year. Just to give you a little more information about that, hopefully. And then we'll have some comments, and then you can have some question time for staff. Any questions you might have for staff, please fire away. And then we'll adjourn. So we'll try to keep this about an hour or so. So if staff can make their presentations about 5 minutes apiece, and then we can leave the time for residents to ask questions about what you've spoken about. All right. So thank you for coming and sit tight. Yes. No, you don't need, I'll introduce you last. Yeah. District 1, Rebecca Chase Williams, Council Rep. Bates Madison, District 3. Joe Gebbia, District 4. And John Park is in Ireland, I believe, so he's the District 2 representative.
Marie's not here.
And Marie is not here. She's got apparently strep throat or something. So Susan Hyde, our clerk, is here. But the bike ped plan, who's going to talk on that?
Not here. I'll just introduce them. Okay. Good evening. Thanks, everybody, for showing up. I'm Bennett White, your Public Works Director. And to start off the presentations today, we're going to start off with a representative from Pond & Company, who's a consultant that is developing our bicycle, pedestrian, and trail plan. Mr. Grant Malone with Pond & Company is going to speak for a few minutes about that, introduce you to that plan if you're not familiar with it.
Okay, hi guys. As I said, my name is Graham Malone, and I'm with Pond & Company. I'm a traffic engineer, and we're the consultant who's working with the city to create the bicycle trail and pedestrian plan. And it's actually in it's very early stages. We've got a few public meetings coming up. We had one actually last week, and I'll talk a little bit about that. But to give you a background of the plan, if you're not familiar with it, what we're trying to do is we're trying to gather input from the community. We're trying to gather technical information to analyze potential routes, and we're going to be developing some concepts for the city to look at, and we're going to be sharing those with you through the website. So I encourage everyone, if they didn't pick up a handout out on the table out front, to grab one. There's a website there for the plan. That's where all of the information will be shared. We have a survey that's going to be posted there next week. And I encourage everyone who's interested in voicing their thoughts and opinions on on bicycle and pedestrian and walking trails and things of that nature to go out and let us know about it, because we need that input from you. To talk a little bit about the meeting that we had last week, it was on the 19th, it was in Linwood Park, and we had a great turnout. I think there were 73 attendees signed in, and I'm sure there were more than that that didn't sign in. We had an excellent, excellent turnout. It's very exciting to see everybody out and supporting that plan. We got a lot of good information from that, and we had a 6 visioning exercise broke out into 6 groups. And one of the things that I noticed right away is that every group kind of came up with some similar ideas. So it's good to see that, you know, there's a path forward, and there's something that the community wants, and we're here to help make that happen, and we're happy to help. So please, again, I encourage you to check the website and check your emails and be a part of this plan. Thank you.
Yeah, let's just go ahead and do that. Why don't we do this with each section, if you have questions about what they were just speaking about, you can ask those questions. If you want to come to the microphone, you can. If you have a loud enough voice like you do, Kathy, you can speak from there.
One of the things that, you know, traditionally is looked at are, you know, either easements or natural buffers, those types of things. Those can offer excellent places, in the North Fork Greenway is an excellent example of that. But it's also keeping in mind that, you know, there's potential within right-of-way for trails that you may not necessarily be aware of in certain places. You can simply add sidewalks or a 10-foot trail in certain places. There are opportunities to narrow travel lanes to incorporate bicycle facilities that way. And I'm sorry, I can't give you an example off the top of my head of a city that was newly established that's trying to do a plan successfully, but I certainly would be happy to look that up and get back to you.
I'm going to try and make the other meetings, and it'd be good to see what other cities have done that have had a situation like ours, because I don't know about everybody else, but I'd love to see those trails everywhere, as much as we can have them, to tie the city together. And I just don't know enough about how it's done to right now understand how it can be done.
Yeah, we can absolutely share that, and going forward, through the website, we can certainly post something up there about that. And hopefully answer your question. Yes?
Are you familiar with the Big Greenway?
I'm sorry?
Are you familiar with the Big Greenway?
The Big Creek Greenway?
Yeah.
I am.
Could we do something like that? Because I like that. That's bridge.
It's certainly a possibility. I don't know. We haven't gotten into the detailed analysis of the feasibility of some of the alignments, but that's certainly nothing is off the table at this point. Yes?
Yes, I'm running mayor. I live over in Ashford Park. I'm the unofficial community leader. Were y'all involved with the hodgepodge off Caldwell Road with the striping of the bicycle lanes, or was that just something done from the city?
I'm aware of the project, but Pond was not involved in that.
Okay, because I would love it.
Ben can address that when he comes up.
Okay, because it is real dangerous, and the bicycle lane is in the center of the road now almost, and it's very scary, and I think we need to revisit this. It's about the third time I've had to say something about it, but it's very dangerous, and I just don't want a death of a child or an adult from where the lanes are, because it doesn't work. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I'm looking at the traffic studies and roadway improvement plan that was had out here. And with regard to Ashford Dunwoody and Dresden, it indicates some intelligent traffic system design. Can you tell us what are the unique features of an ITS and how do they work?
That's another question for Public Works. We'll take those two when Bennett comes up, but so just hold that in reserve. So more questions about the bike and ped and trail plan.
Yeah. I have a suggestion. I know that Indianapolis, Indiana is implementing this. I know somebody's involved and they're trying to do their entire city. And apparently moving along pretty good with it. It might be something you'd want to look at to see how they're doing.
Yeah, absolutely. And if we've done plans of this nature and scale in various areas around the city and the state, or around the state, as far as a newer city being able to incorporate and going back and looking at something that has already been established over a period of years is something that I'm not aware of.
Because I think they started implementing this just 3 years ago.
Right. Okay.
I mean, it's a new deal. Mm-hmm. And a neighbor of Brookhaven is involved in it now. So, yeah.
You mentioned earlier about the possibility of narrowing traffic lanes, and I was just curious, similar to his question, but will you have to wait for the city's traffic study to implement your plan, or will it take that into account before you start making plans to where these lanes are going
to
go?
We plan to coordinate with the city and all aspects, especially when we start getting into the feasibility of certain routes and what's going to be going in and any planned projects that are coming from that. And so we certainly will be incorporating that into our work.
Anything else on the bike and trail plan?
I have a question.
Yes.
I'm sure some of y'all might be thinking, but are we going to be coordinating with the other municipalities and counties in our plan? So DeKalb County's bike ped plan, City of Atlanta's got a big bicycle czar, I think they've appointed. Are we going to be coordinating with that?
Yeah, we will have some level of coordination with the jurisdictions outside of the city, because that was one of the things that came from that first meeting, was that there's a great desire to connect to some of those plans, the Path 400 Trail, the work that Shamley's doing,
right,
the redevelopment they're doing over by where the Whole Foods is going to be going in, and also connecting to the Beltline too, that spur there.
Great. And as an output of this plan, will we have concrete steps that we can implement both on the short term and long term?
Absolutely.
There's not going to be anything in there that says we need another study to do.
No.
This.
No.
Good. Thank you.
No. Yeah. We try to detail and create an implementation schedule that's going to have some short term projects that are some of the low hanging fruits that can right off the bat, and then some of the ones that there may be something that will require a further feasibility study, if it's along a creek bed or something of that nature, but we absolutely will be providing something that the city can go out and achieve very quickly as well.
Got one up here.
I was driving the other day in the city of Sandy Spring, and right by the Johnson Ferry and Avernity, I saw something like really great. Looking park, I think it's called Abernathy Greenway or something.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering if we have any future plan for something in the area.
I've seen that and I'm aware of what you're talking about, and when I drove by it I was impressed by it too. She said that she was in Sandy Springs and she was driving by the Abernathy Greenway, if anybody is familiar with that area, and she was asking if there was something the city of Brookhaven to implement, if that was something that could be done. And if that is something that the public is interested in, then absolutely we want to hear from you, and I'll certainly take that into consideration, that's something that you're wanting, is these big open space and kind of passive parks. It does. It does. It really does. We've heard that concern,
right,
and that's something that we're going to be looking at. I don't have an answer for you immediately, but we are aware of the challenges of crossing Peachtree Boulevard and crossing the MARTA line as well. It's going to be something that we're certainly looking into.
Yeah, that's a very, very important question. I know we've all talked about that. How do we get, if you really want to be a truly connected, walkable city, how do you get people across Peachtree? We've seen some preliminary proposals for development that would put a bridge over, a sky pedestrian bridge over Peachtree. We've also talked about and heard some ideas about a tunnel under Peachtree, sort of coming out near where town Brookhaven is or near Oglethorpe. But the we already have one death there on right when we started the city from a lady who was crossing near the Waffle House. And so first thing we need to do is get the traffic plan, this traffic study's done, but clearly delineating like we've done on Ashford Dunwoody, we're going to be doing on Dresden this summer with the flashing crosswalks, the clearly marked crosswalks with whether it's brick pavers and just making a big deal out of, a bigger deal out of crosswalks. And I think that's, you start to set the tone with enforcement of crosswalks, and I know the chief is aware of that. They've been working on enforcing people blowing through crosswalks when it's flashing. I think that that'll be something that's a big priority for all of us, is making sure pedestrians can cross safely, not just Peachtree, but any busier street. Well, thank you. And the sidewalks are going to help too. I mean, they'll like, keep you from having to cross in so many different places as we get more and more sidewalks.
Graham, I have two questions for you.
Yes, sir.
And this is both about implementation now.
Okay.
It's great to have a great plan, but implementation is critical. So, if I'm correct, you tell me that this plan should be done by January or first quarter of 2016?
That's our intended date, yes, sir.
In your best judgment, how long do you think it would take once the plan is completed, when residents would see the finished product?
Well, that's largely going to depend on the funding status. You know, if it's going to be, you know, if there's going to be grants that are going to be applied for, if there's going to be money that's going to be applied for through the ARC or through the TIP process. That's one thing that can potentially add some time to the implementation of a project. There's also the design elements, but I would think that you know, depending on how eager and ambitious the city is with the plans, I would say that, you know, certainly there will be something that could be done within a year or two. I mean, I can't speak because I don't know exactly what our recommendations are going to be, but we do try to have short-term projects that are implementable in a 1 to 5 year period. So from the end of the plan through 5 years.
One more question. When our citizens or people have their brilliant ideas in the middle of the night about bike ped plans that they want to get and communicate to you, how can they do that? So an email address and the city or the website?
We do. We have an email address. It's very long, so I won't bore you with it, but it is on the handout that I mentioned earlier. There's a stack of them out on the table. If you didn't grab one, I encourage you to get one. You can go to the Brookhaven website. It's in the Public Works area, and there's a bicycle, pedestrian and trail plan link there that you can go to, and there's that will take any communications that you make there will go directly to us, and we'll be able to catalog it and incorporate it into the plan.
What about your home address? Can they get your home address?
Absolutely not.
Especially in the middle of the night, you need to be able to show up with your
Yes, ma'am.
The most amazing place I've been to as far as bike paths is Amsterdam. Have people from your company been there, and could that be a place that we could go and learn from? I mean, as many people commute to work on bicycles as they do in cars.
True.
And it's a whole community based on cycling. It's pretty amazing.
It is, and we actually have a staff, he's a younger staff, a junior engineer who spent some time in Amsterdam, so that's actually exciting to be able to use his knowledge, because he did bring a lot to the table from that. Amsterdam, you know, and that culture there, the biking over driving is something that's been ingrained in people for many years, so it's, in a way, it's hard to overcome some of the dependency that we have on private and on personal cars, but there's absolutely lessons to be learned. So,
well, I guess what I'm thinking,
you bring
is
up a good point.
The more that we attract businesses to the community, and the more that people actually can work nearby, it becomes more and more feasible that people can really ride their bikes to work. And you know, that will certainly help as we're getting developed more and more to cut down on traffic.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So anyway,
especially within proximity to the BARTA stations that are on Peachtree, and up by the medical center. So there's definitely opportunities to create a commute to work that doesn't involve a car. So
I think we need to send some of our elected officials over there. I don't even mind paying for their trip over there so they can really see what the potential is.
Kathy, I'll say, I've been there many times. I've studied in Germany in college. I very much believe in that European mentality of anything other than having to get in your car to go to the things that you do during your day. So I will absolutely represent those interests within our council here. But our city's only 12 square miles. So I agree that we really need to take a look at how we connect the entire city. Right when we started the city, there was I think it was Channel 46 did a story, a piece on how we could make the city of Brookhaven a walkable, bikeable community in which residents, once they got home, would not have to get in their car anymore. But we are going to need to focus on some of the other issues, like our workforce, our workforce space, more commercial office space. We really have a shortage in our Peace Road corridor. We have some outdated product on Buford Highway.
And you mentioned the small size of the city. You know, that's one thing that we heard at the first public meeting, was there are a lot of communities that kind of feel isolated when you look at it from a walking or a bikeable perspective. And so that's something that can easily be achieved by making small interconnections between neighborhoods. And that's something to consider, that, you know, you can take these lower volume residential roads and kind of turn them into something that's more of a biking or a walking thoroughfare too. And cars can operate on them because of the volumes and the speeds are so low. So it's going to be a kind of shared network, if you will. And that's some of the important things to keep in mind, because you know, there isn't a lot of space, and it's going to be important to think about that moving forward.
Anything else on the bike and trail plan? Well, thank you very much, Graham. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you,
guys.
All right, now we have Is Mark Holmberg here?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Graham. Another planning effort that's underway under the purview or the overview of Public Works is the North Fork Peachtree Greenway Master Plan. And we have Mark Holmberg from Ethan Lineback that will speak to you about that. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Mark Holmberg. We're working with the city to develop a greenway along North Fork Peachtree Creek. We are in the early phases of gathering information from everybody in this room about what you would like to see that area become. We're very excited about the project and its potential. It's a lovely area. In areas, there's some very tough access, and then there's some very easy access areas. So stop by, take a look at the map that we have, and give us your input. Carlos Perez is working with us, and he'd like to say just a little bit about it, and then we'll take questions.
Thank you, Mark. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for taking the time to stop by before the meeting to share your thoughts, and we're definitely looking forward to getting additional thoughts before you leave. But as Mark mentioned, we're in the very early stages of the process, data gathering stage, in terms of understanding existing conditions of the corridor. Next step in this will be going out to the public and getting input, but we figured as part of this meeting, we would start gathering input immediately, so we look forward to getting that input after the meeting as well. But please do be on the lookout for future notice on when we'll be going out to the public. We're working with the city on developing that strategy at the moment, and we look forward to getting your input.
Hey, do we have any questions on the North Fork Greenway map?
Sorry, can you just give a quick synopsis of what that
Sure, it's just south of the Buford Highway corridor, in between Buford Highway and I-85. It's within city limits. You probably haven't seen it because it's behind a lot of the buildings on the south side of Buford Highway. So we're essentially looking at the entire corridor that's within city limits to understand its potential for creating a great greenway system along it.
If you go down, park at the car wash on Druid Hills and get out and walk down the sidewalk across the bridge on Druid Hills, look to your left and right, it's a beautiful shot of what that can be. I mean, it's crystal clear water. I know it's probably polluted in some way, but it just looks beautiful, the huge rocks and steep banks. It can be a really nice greenway. And that's when we, from the beginning, Joe, we've been talking about this, we've all seen the potential there. So it's got the potential for an exciting, wonderful place for people to utilize nature right in the middle of the city and can connect to the Beltline as well.
Does the city already own it? We don't have to acquire it, do we?
We own some of it, but we're going to have to acquire some more. Basically, the property right now is not too valuable to the businesses that sit along Buford Highway. It's because it's not utilized and it's flood. You know, they're
unbuildable.
Yeah, it's unbuildable. So you don't. It shouldn't be too expensive. The easements are. You know, I think some of the businesses. It'll help spur development along the creek. You know, if you can get some assemblages there that. Some developers want to come in and buy some of that property and put a nice restaurant complex that faces the creek. You know, we can have decks overlooking the creek and people coming up on their kayaks to come eat. That's the kind of thing that would be great.
Happening all over the Beltline.
Right.
Did you want to comment on that? It's in your district.
Yeah, I really do. You know, the city was built with a very strong love for parks. Unfortunately, in the 4th District, we don't have a park at all. A park. So this is a pretty aggressive undertaking, and it's something that I thought about since, obviously, we were elected in November. That following January 2014, I walked the creek and said, looked in a vision and saw this could be a really good asset for the city. So it really got a set of legs on its own. We got a lot of assistance from Betsy Edgars, who's running the nonprofit portion of the North Fork Creek. Enhancement is a 501c3, which is important to the development of this. And this is a phenomenal undertaking. And just the fact that we're here having this conversation, we've got the assistance now of doing some formal planning, really shows that there's a seriousness in moving forward with this. It'll be, the objective is to eventually tie it into the Beltline. That's one of the objectives I'd like to see. And Betsy Edgars and her group are actually looking at it more from a regional perspective and looking to take it down to Mercer University or taking it up through Chamblee and eventually connecting it to Blackburn Park, which will help connect us with the rest of our parks. So there's a lot of synergy to this. The economic development opportunities that this affords the Buford Highway as we move forward are huge. Combined with what we've done with our Buford Highway economic redevelopment plan, this is an integral part. We've had professionals come out and who have looked at this, national professionals, and they have stated openly that for every dollar we invest in this park, we'll get $9 back. So it's huge. Some of the sites that were developed, that were shown for redevelopment, accentuated the beauty of the creek for condos or mixed use. Kind of like, think of Dresden along a nice creek. You know, some of the looks of what we have along Dresden. And it's going to be a part of this this redevelopment, this whole process, what we see going on. Which I haven't heard, and I mentioned it to some nice people tonight that we were outside, is Brookhaven has an opportunity zone application in with the state, and it's for Buford Highway. We have a lot of competition for it, so there's going to be some stiff, and they're not giving out a whole lot of those as they used to do in previous years, so we're putting together our best strategy to make sure that we get it. But with an opportunity zone, it's going to attract a lot of businesses. Potentially to come in and reestablish. And the quality of the businesses that we get, we've been told, will be heightened by the completion of this path. Just like what's going on over on Ponce at City Market. That place is it's phenomenal what the Beltline has done over there, redevelopment for businesses and just the whole economic viability of that area. There's the same potential for us to have that type of, to have a similar type of outcome. With this parkway, we have the opportunity to be 3.2 miles right now. I think we're looking at 2.5. But if it does get connected to the Beltline, if we can figure that part out, it'll be one of the most unique portions of the Beltline. For people to take that trip along the Beltline and come along a creek path like this, I mean, it'll be a statement park for Brookhaven, just like a lot of the other things that we've been doing here in the city. I'm really proud of this effort, I really think this is going to move forward very positively. As far as the easement rights, and the mayor mentioned earlier, part of the incentives that we can offer to properties that have land that abut the creek, well, we can give them a tax abatement. We can allow them to take it off their tax roll and lessen their tax burden by yielding it to the city. And most of it's floodplain zone anyway, it's not usable. And when we did our creek ordinance, we accounted for the installation of a path. So we're set to go.
Anything else on the Warfort Creekway, Greenway? All right. Well, who wants to go next? We got Chief, you want to go? Thank you all very much, by the way.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Gary Under, the police chief. This place brings back memories to me. It was July 15, 2013. Mayor and council was here, and we actually swore in our entire police department here. So thank you, Father Harhager, for providing the beautiful location and all the assets that were here to assist us in our training, because we were here for a full 2 weeks of training. So that being said, what I did was I collected some of the data that we've accomplished just in this 2.5 year period, which is kind of amazing when I start collecting it today. Just for everyone's information, we average like 160 to 210 calls per service a day. And that includes initiated calls from officers, calls that we receive from you, 911 calls, the whole gamut. We took, since we started up July 31st, 2013, we completed 9,754 reports. That's for serious incidents where officers actually write reports. We've made 2,340 custodial arrests. And what was amazing out of that, 284 of those were wanted people, either on traffic stops or just checking people. Our officers have written 18,751 citations or ordinance violations, and that includes everything from seat belts to speeding to noise violations. Or we get a lot of complaints, construction violations and things like that. We've collected over $1,250,000 in fines and forfeitures. An amazing thing is, one of the things we requested, and I asked, and I says, this would pay off to the police department and to the residents in the city, but we were actually requested by the federal agencies, Homeland Security, DEA, and the FBI to put a person in, because our officers are doing such a great job, they're getting a great reputation. So they asked us to put a person in, it's an elite strike force. We put an officer in there, and in 3 months, he was involved in the seizure of over $700,000 in cash and over $3 million in seizure of illegal drugs. So out of that $700,000 in cash, that's actually split up by the agents in the task force. So we're going to get a pretty big percentage. One of them was $461,000. We'll end up with a big percentage of that. And that money can only be used for giving back to the community for programs like we're doing a Citizens Police Academy right now. Could be used for our Explorer program, which we have, things like that. So we're still waiting to find out how much we're gonna get out of it. We implemented a lot of other positive things, and that was with the assistance of the entire community. Our AED program, we just had our second save last week with a 56-year-old female on West Nancy Creek. Narcan, we actually went out, and well, the AEDs actually was provided by the foundation through a lot of the residents in Brookhaven, which assist us, Friends of Brookhaven. We applied for a grant for, it's a drug, anti-drug Narcan, which actually turns around the effects of heroin overdoses and some other drug overdoses. We made one save with that already. All our officers carry that along with the AEDs in their cars. Another positive thing that we're able to do in the past 2.5 years was we hired a crime analyst. The crime analyst, actually, we stole her from Newton County. She's actually a certified officer also, so we could use her a dual purpose. But she enables us to work smarter. If we have, for instance, I'll give you an example. We had an armed robbery at a gas station along North Druid Hills. She was able to identify the person involved in the armed robbery, We went out to Norcross. He lived in Norcross. Through her efforts, we were able to make the arrest for our armed robbery, clear up a bank robbery in Norcross, and two other armed robberies in DeKalb County. So it's kind of amazing what you can do sitting at a desk, analyzing crime and figuring out. She tells our officers where to be, what time to be there, and what day to be there, and that's helping us out tremendously. Some of the other things that we're doing with other agencies, North Metro SWAT, we're working with them. I'm a firm believer that, you know, it's better to work smarter and not deplete all our resources. So we'll have, I think we've got four officers right now assigned to the SWAT team. Those officers are the best that we could possibly give them for the SWAT team. All the other agencies, which include Dunwoody and Sandy Springs and Johns Creek, they have similar assets involved with it. So they get the best training. We don't deplete our resources and allows our officers to stay on the road more often. The other thing we're working on right now, along with the SWAT team, is a mobile field force. With everything going on in the world today, you see the riots and protests and things like that going on. We just want to be prepared. So we're actually partnering, I think, with Alpharetta's interested in joining with us. So the entire area, including the city of Atlanta and DeKalb, we're looking to try to join forces with. And for those of you who don't know, we actually had the Occupy Atlanta group here at our McDonald's on Peachtree about 4 months ago. And it was kept quiet. We kept it under control, and it worked out great because a lot of that is just media attention, and we didn't want to give it to them. So we went up to the leader of the group and said, we're not going to put up with blocking roads, because this was 5 o'clock in the afternoon on Friday. And we had the cab waiting by to assist us, Georgia State Patrol in Atlanta, and everything worked out great. They cooperated with us. We said, we want you to be successful, and we want to be successful too. We don't want to interrupt any businesses, and it worked out great. Other than that, as I mentioned, we're getting a great reputation with all the agencies. I just came back, you know, we just talked about Amsterdam. I spent 4 hours in Amsterdam on Saturday. I didn't hear anything about bike paths. All I was told was don't eat brownies there, so. But it was amazing for me. It was the first experience I had, but we were actually requested from the State Department, the U.S. Embassy in Tbilisi, Georgia, the other Georgia, to go there and assess. It was myself, Director GBI Vernon Keenan, and three other chiefs. We were guests of the U.S. Embassy and the State Department. We went there to assess. They fired 16,000 of their police force, which was their entire police force, back in 2007. They have 7,000 back in their program right now. It's National Police Force. We actually work with the Minister of Internal Affairs, which is the head of all law enforcement, court authority, and everything for the entire country. We toured all our facilities. GBI's been working with them, training them, and we're setting up an exchange program. So it was kind of exciting. They're actually going to be coming here, and I think they're coming to Brookhaven probably in the fall. So we're looking forward to that. So,
Dad, any questions? Georgian police officers here?
If you could understand them, I didn't understand a word they said. But they did have one
Tell
thing.
Tell them no roughhousing. I know how they do things over Eastern Europe.
Well, they did have one thing there that I wasn't used to in this country. We visited 7 police stations, and 2 of the police chiefs from the each precinct has their own police chief. Well, we see bottles of wine that they have in their office from each of the police chiefs. So
okay. Questions for the chief? Yes, sir.
I'd like to just say that I personally would like to pat you on your back and all of your officers, and I usually, every time I see one of them, if I'm out of my car, I'm going, thank them. But we really appreciate what you do and what your officers do. We are not.
Thank you very much. Now, Lieutenant Eric Silvius is here. He's running the shift tonight. These are the folks that are out there every day. And you know, as I mentioned, when we first started up, we had a ceremony or whatever. When the officers are on the street, I mean, just a regular patrol officer, 3 o'clock in the morning, he's a counselor, he's an attorney, he's a judge. He's everything. And then if something bad happens, the attorneys unfortunately have weeks and years to go and check and file suits or whatever they're gonna do. One thing we told our officers is if you end up in a confrontation, we want that officer to go home safe. And that's one of the things we're trying to promote with our Citizens Police Academy, so there's a push for that too. Actually, there's a Citizens Police Academy going on right now as we speak, and Father, I hate to say it, but they're in air conditioning right now, so. But there's, we've got 30 in the class, and we're gonna probably hold 2 classes a year, so we're looking forward to getting everyone involved in that. We couldn't do this without the support of the entire community too. Yes.
Is there ever going to be a direct line to the police department? Because currently right now you have to go through 911, and when you call, it does take a while to get there.
No, there is. Well, it should.
I've called before, and it does not.
911?
No, you go through 911, but it takes a while because they have to.
There is a direct line. It's 404-637-0600, and that should be on the website.
I've tried looking at before, and they've given me one, and it doesn't go anywhere.
Right. It's the same number as City Hall. Just remember, City Hall is 0500, and ours is 0600.
Thank you.
Sure.
But you do, I mean, I've talked to you about this. We do have our own 911 service now. So the initial, you know, the first year and a half of the city, we were still relying completely on DeKalb's 911. And then it's been the last, 9, 10 months, or a year?
About a year now. Yeah,
that we've had our own 911. The 911 wait times have improved significantly. And if you've called in the last few months.
I still get a chance. I get whenever I call, I mean, obviously, most people call from cell phones nowadays. I don't know because where you are.
Right.
But, like, we live across the street from the school, and there's kids always playing on the roof. So I'm constantly calling about that.
Where do you live exactly? Because there are some issues. They've been working on the cell tower issues that are on the borders.
We're on borders. We're on the entire elementary, so we're, like, right on the corner.
Keep in mind, that's one of the things, part of our Citizens Police Academy, the second class, everyone went to ChatCom, the actual building. And that's probably one of the most enjoyable parts, other than tonight they're doing crime scenes, so that we got bodies all over our station. So, yes?
I have a question. I live on Ashford Dunwoody, and I have for over 25 years. We're having a serious increase in the 53-foot 18-wheelers that are coming out. We've got loaded gas tanks, trucks. We've got car carriers that are coming through. But those 53-footers, other than in the mornings and in the afternoons when the traffic is heavy and it's going to be heavy anywhere, those trucks fly down our street.
If you could call up and give us a times when it's most prevalent, we can monitor the area. The problem is, like, the gas tankers, if they have a local delivery, say, to the gas station.
But they're supposed to go Peachtree Industrial.
Yeah.
They're not supposed, no truck over 30 feet at a certain way is supposed to come down through there.
I know.
Is that a code? Is that a code? Is that a law? Is that a code in the?
Yeah, it's on the side.
Okay.
It's on the sign. We have checker codes, though.
Yeah.
But we had complaints.
It's always been our understanding over the years that it's local deliveries only.
Right.
They're supposed to use Peachtree Industrial because they can come in Peachtree Industrial and be right there. And then you won't have the kids in Montgomery, the kids at the Y, the kids coming out of Harris, and the kids, you know, all the people crossing up the Library Park. I've actually followed some of these trucks, and they're using it as a fatless. But I actually have a photograph of a Cisco 18-wheeler that jackknifes that's going so fast his wheels popped up in the Montgomery school zone.
Okay.
So if we could maybe.
Yeah, well, we could beef up our patrols and
everything. So, I mean, if you could, that would be great, because those trucks fly. We had a shredded truck come by yesterday when I was on my way here in the rain doing about 60.
Okay.
So should I call, or?
Well, by the time you call, if it's one truck, probably they're going to be gone. But if you can give us times to.
Okay. Just try to start logging the times that I see my stuff.
Yeah.
Some pictures.
Oh, I've got pictures, believe me.
The license gets.
And movies. I get up for work at 4 a.m. every morning, so I'm in bed early. But there's nothing worse than 2 o'clock in the morning. Having a truck coming through using their J-brakes, that'll just roll you right out of bed quick. But they do fly, so, okay. But I'll start trying to log them.
Yeah, I just have a quick question. So obviously you guys are doing a lot of support, and you guys are doing really well in getting a ton of accolades. For crime statistics specifically, are we seeing those declining in the area? Because, you know, one of the big ideas around police force.
We actually have, we still have problems on Buford Highway, as expected, because a lot of that crime is imported from other areas. Some of it's taking place from within. We're working on it. The crime has, I saw what we did last time was we compared the last 2 months, and the crime has decreased the last 2 months. We'll provide that in the yearly report.
Yeah, Chief, from the beginning, when we first started off, you'd always said, initially, for the first year or so, we're gonna have a spike in crime because there's so much crime not being found and unpatrolled and reports not having taken by the previous jurisdiction. So, you know, we did see that spike for the first year or so, and it's good to hear now that once you've got a full year of records and your enforcement has picked up, that it is going down.
Yeah, and a lot of the crime that we're solving is a result of you all helping us out with the information. I mean, we've had one murder since we started. That was on Buford Highway. It occurred about noon during the week. And that was solved within 5 hours. We recovered a gun and everything. And it was because of cooperation. And actually, that was from cooperation from the Hispanic neighborhood. And that was one of the first things we did before we even started patrol, was reached out to the community and tried to gain their support and report crimes. So whether you know it or not, you know, a lot of that area, there are a lot of undocumented people out there. And we told them that it's not really our job, you know, unless they commit a crime. All we're interested in is if you're a victim of a crime or if you commit a crime, you're going to have issues with us. And so far, that's been working very well. Anything else?
Well, one of the recent cases that when I kept hearing on the news about the Brookhaven rapist, I was like, oh gosh, that's terrible for us. But then I talked to the officers who had worked the case, and I'm proud to say it was all really good, hard police work that in fact solved that case. It was not only, you know, good footwork, getting an ID with the cooperation of the community, but literally diving into dumpsters to find the clothes that this guy had thrown off that I think gave us the DNA, that not only gave us a positive ID, but then linked him to a series of rapes in other jurisdictions. And then I think because we've got such a good relationship with the Marshal Service, he ended up being picked up, is that correct, by the U.S.
What
Marshals?
What happens, we call the Secret Service, and they helped us ping the phone or whatever. So we actually found the phone for this guy in, I believe we found him in Opelika. Actually, he just was returned to Georgia, so he's in the DeKalb jail. As a matter of fact, just returned to Georgia jail today. But we found the phone in Auburn, so we sent Auburn police in Alabama to a house. We found the phone, but the person wasn't there, so it took about 2 weeks to track him down. And thank God the people in Opelika actually helped us out, and somebody called in and saw him in front of a convenience store, so that helped us out. But as Rebecca was saying, the dumpster diving, that actually did happen. We had, when the guy committed a rape, he went back to the victim of the rape actually scratched the heck out of his face and bit him. We had a witness that actually saw him go back to an apartment with the scratches and everything. Saw him take off his clothes because they were bloody from the scratches, and he threw it in a dumpster. Well, the next day, we found out which dumpster it was, and the apartment dumpsters, if you know, are huge, and you can't figure out what's in there. Well, we had four officers follow the dumpster as a chain of custody all the way to Norcross to a transfer station where they dumped it out. We had unloaders waiting, and they really did go dumpster diving. So it's kind of dirty work.
So I just want to point out, this is the kind of really great hard work that our police officers do that you often don't hear about. But because of this hard work and good police work and working smarter, you know, this really bad guy is now behind bars, who's been connected with multiple rapes, I believe. And
we thought he was. Roswell's chief called up because it was, there were a lot of similarities, but the DNA didn't match.
Okay.
So.
But in any case, a bad guy is off the street, thanks to our good cops.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Chief, we got a phone call last week from one of the residents in National Park, John Walmack, and he told me that last week was National Officers Week. Well, we did a luncheon for all the Brookhaven officers at the station, my wife and I, and John sponsored it. And we fed all the officers. And just like the gentleman said earlier, when I see a Brookhaven squad car, always toot the horn, always honk the horn, wave. Thank you very much. I think everybody will at least stand up for half a second and give the chief a standing ovation, because he has done a fantabulous job with everything we got here in Brookhaven.
We got a grant in for a traffic unit, and if you happen to be around Buford Highway, I think it was May 7th. Actually, I just got the video today. We videotaped the whole thing. We had Georgia State Patrol's helicopter and 120 police officers where we did road checks. So,
Also, we've mentioned this every time we have a town hall and the chief presents. I want to remind everybody, and I mentioned it earlier, about the vacation program, that when you go on vacation, just tell them exactly what it is again.
You go to our website, you can fill out a simple form, just tell us when you're gone, your address, key holder information, how to get a hold of somebody in case of emergency, any lights, cars in the driveway, or things like that, and the officers will actually go around and check your house for you. And when you come back, you'll actually get a letter showing when it was checked and what they found. Hopefully nothing. No, we don't take dogs out.
It has been known to get mail out of the box in the driveway after it was, I've heard that's happened before too.
Yes, ma'am.
I also want to give you huge kudos because two of your officers spent about 2.5 hours at our school earlier this week. Officer Young and Officer Miller, which are part of your community outreach, I believe.
In your school?
Yes.
Which school?
Okay, we do reading programs at Woodward Elementary School a couple times a month. We just provided a, believe it or not, Eagle Rock Distributors, who the owners of that live in Brookhaven. They didn't want to be known as sponsoring it, but they sponsored the DUI. They brought in an excellent speaker that actually brought tears to everybody's eyes. All the juniors and seniors at Cross Keys High School attended it, and it was just prior to prom, so it was great timing.
The officers actually spent a lot of time really going through our emergency plan, doing a campus walkthrough, really providing some additional information, so we're doing everything we can to keep our students safe as well as our faculty safe, and it was unbelievably helpful, and they were wonderful, so I wanted to pass that.
Thank you. I'll pass it on.
Anything else for the chief?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
One last one.
Did the officers think we were weird because we might have?
No, but it's on you. I'll be honest with you. This is my 40th year in law enforcement, and I've never worked
with. If we think the officers think that the citizens are weird, if the citizens wave at them.
No, it's we appreciate it. I've never seen anything like this. You know, when we first started up, officers used to go in restaurants and they used to get standing ovations. So it's amazing. And I told them it's their job to keep that up.
You can't feed the officers. It's not like you don't feed the dirt. You can't feed them.
Feeding us too much, though.
Thank you.
Thank you. This is Jerry Kinsey, our Parks and Recs Director.
Good evening. Thanks to everybody for coming out tonight. I'm going to go over a brief description of what we're doing in the Parks and Recreation Department, what we're trying to achieve. And we're just moving forward. But first, when I first got here, we had two recreation centers. One was closed, Briarwood Recreation Center, and Linwood was being in the middle of a remodeling. And we got out there and we redid the gym, the old gym, put up new backboards. Volleyball standards are up, and so we can have different programs and things going on in the rec center. We also have meeting rooms, activity rooms, where we have classes, Pilates, and things like that for the youth and adults. We also have big meeting rooms up there, family activities or community meetings. And at Briarwood's the same thing. It's a little bit smaller gym, but it's we put a new floor there, so it's we're getting more use out of it. With those two rec centers being ready to go now, we can have more activities, more programs going on. We also started out by really just taking care of the parks. So DeKalb County got over 10 parks. And we're still looking forward to getting two more parks from them, which is Brookhaven and Osborne Park. When we receive those two, we can start redoing those also. We have been doing a little work at Brookhaven. We have been putting in side amenities at all the parks, which is benches, swings. We're doing small steps right now. I'm looking forward to doing bigger steps. But we're getting our parks looking good, safe, and we're going to be more active and community oriented. We got involved in our pool houses renovation. If anybody was involved in the pools last year, I hope you go this year. The pool houses look 100% better. The swimming pools are better. We have some swim teams in the community that act to use them, and the community comes out. So we had a good activity over the weekend. We had a lot of participants come out. We're also doing restroom repairs and pavilion repairs at all of our parks, painting them up, getting them to look better, more attractive. At Blackburn Park, we redid the big large pavilion. We have a mini company picnics there. The community events. The YMCA uses that area for some of their programming. And also for the upcoming events, projects coming up. We're about to do the stadium repair at Murphy County. We're going to remodel the stadium. We're going to put outside coating on it and also put ventilations in the locker rooms for the kids. We also are going to come out, research some 8 tennis courts, Murphy County, Briarwood, Linwood, and also Ashford. This will be coming up. We should have all those courts resurfaced in the next 8 weeks. Park site specific master plans. We had 10 firms to bid on this. We have staff that are grading these parks, these firms, and then what we'll do, we'll interview the end of next week, hopefully, if we can get it arranged for the next week, and we'll select. We'll interview 3 firms, and then we'll make recommendations to city council and move forward. We hope for that. That will really help know which direction we're going and what these parks really need. We got Ashford Park Playground. It's being bid out, and bids are due back June the 23rd. Then we'll have public meetings and pick and select our playground that'll be going in there. Also have a baseball pavilion, a practice pavilion being bid out for Murphy County. We're going out for bid again. We bid it, it's design build. And I don't know if somebody just didn't want to design build a practice pavilion, but we're going to have to solicit again and then come back in for other bids. Blackman Park parking lot is being drawn up now, 23 spaces. That'll be up by the big pavilion at Blackburn. And also we have our main signs are coming up for all our parks. We get rid of the DeKalb County signs that show that it is the parks of Brookhaven. We're adding restrooms at Blackburn and Skyland. And that's one of the main things I think these parks need is really your parking, your lighting for security reasons, and your hardscape, just fixing them up and dressing them up. People can enjoy them more. We have brochures out in the lobby, tells you what all our activities and programs are going on. We come out 3 times a year with these programs. You're welcome to pick one up in the lobby, or we can answer any questions about what we have taking place. We have just formed a park and recreation committee. We meet once a month at City Hall. They meet at 12 o'clock, the third Wednesday of each month. If you see any problems or you got something you want resolved, you're welcome to come to the meeting. We have public input there, and you also call us anytime for any problems or anything you see in the parks. Also, we have a park committee, PARC. They've been involved, I guess, since the city of Brookhaven. They might have been involved before the city of Brookhaven, but it's a great committee, very active. We got a lot of active people in this city that cares about their parks. And they're really going to see them improve. But with that, I'll answer any questions.
Yes, ma'am. I walk through Blackburn Park a lot.
Yes, ma'am.
And I've read the sign for rules, and I see people smoking in the park. And I just wondered if, you know, our parks could not be no smoking parks.
That's something we'd have to pass a policy just. You know, take it before city council and see if we do it. There are other parks in the state. Where I came from, we had smoking areas. You had to smoke within 25 feet of a sign, and it got them away from the active playing fields and other activities.
Well, I've seen them on the new swings.
Right.
Smoking. You know, cigarette butts are on the ground.
And you think they come to the park
and
be healthy.
It's a shame that people smoke in the park.
I agree.
We were over at the Cherry Blossom Festival. We were a couple of visitors, and one thing I noticed when the vendors had parked over here at the picnic pavilion, going down that walkway, it was just a pitch dark when we were having to do there. And I actually fell down once trying to get down that hill there. Are there any plans to put any lighting along those walkways at all?
Yes, sir. It'll be part of the plans coming up. We'll go light the sidewalks and the walking trails.
Excellent.
More lights on the parking lot.
It's my understanding that Murphy Candler is operated, or at least the fields are operated by the Little Leagues there. I feel like there's an opportunity for some of the adult social leagues to also play on those fields and whatnot. Is that an opportunity?
The Murphy County Little League Association, we deal with several youth associations. Mm-hmm. And that is where the youth play, the adults. We have adult softball, adult flag football, and we play those out of Blackman. So So if you want to pay any adult fees, just contact us and we get you in touch.
That's like, I mean, the opportunities there would be, I mean these leagues pay for the fields and everything. It'd be a great opportunity for us to bring in some money and a different place to bring in people to Brookhaven.
The leagues that we have, they have exclusive use for their season, but anytime all season and when there's not planning going on, you can use the fields if there are less than, I think, 10 people, but you have to get permission if there's more, because you know they have an interest in keeping the field in shape. But you can go on the fields, and we need to get the signage correct on that to let people know. We have some, we did a lot around the baseball, but there are times the fields are not being used by the leagues, even though they're paying for them, that anybody can use the fields. So I understand what you're saying. We've addressed that issue before with some of the ultimate frisbee folks and some other, the flag football folks, but we have a lot of unutilized space for that type of activity, especially at Linwood Park with the huge field there that's never, I guess, kickball down there. We have adult kickball.
Right, adult kickballs in the banks.
And some other things. But I would come by the rec department if you have some activities and friends that want to do that kind of stuff. Just find out when they're available, what fields are available, things that aren't, there are places you can play that aren't being utilized at all right now.
Can I just real quick, involved with Murphy Candler. If you go to murphycandler.org, you can see on our website our schedules and when games and things are being played. In addition to that, there are also times where those fields and the Colt fields and Mustang fields are being planed or being treated. Football fields are closed for the next 8 weeks because they're being treated. And that's usually on the website when that kind of work is being done so that you can have a better idea of when it's available.
And also,
unless it rains in the spring, then it's never available because we're still trying to make up games.
The football and baseball programs are two of the finest in the country, and they need to be protected by the city and with other areas that the adults can play. We need to maybe make it known that we have other places to put programs for adults, but we need to also protect what is one of the finest assets of the city that came with the organization of the city.
The Colts are celebrating their 50th anniversary this year, and I think that's coming up pretty soon. It'd be interesting to come to that and see the history of the program.
Yes. What's your latest update on the PEK Ashford Park green space?
That'd be kind of a John Park issue, but we the latest update was, I guess the last thing that happened at the park was that DeKalb County put up a no trespassing sign. Many of you might know or might not know that there's, I think it's 32 acres, that extra parcel is 32 acres of forest that is across the street from PDK on Claremont in Brookhaven that is owned by DeKalb County. And it was the crash zone for the runway that is now closed. So the airport no longer has a need for the crash zone. So there's this 32 acres there and right in the right National Park. It's a great space. I've walked it. There are trails that citizens have kind of cut into it and kind of maintained. So the issue, we are looking as a council at trying to find ways to purchase at least some of that property to preserve some of our green space, and the places along Claremont would have to be they're already sort of developed. It's a site for dumping of asphalt, and there's some of the road crews going to work out of there. So there's a few front acres would be the area that where there would be a development in order to pay for that, pay for the property. So we need to preserve what we can preserve, and it'd be expensive because the law is that they get free fair market value, and the free market determines what the price is. So it's several million dollars. And go ahead. Yeah, several million dollars. And we have, as a council, have discussed ways to try and purchase that, try to acquire, try to protect whatever we can protect. And we look forward to working with DeKalb County on that. It's very important, very rare thing to have. And if you haven't had a chance to, I guess you can't walk it now without permission because they got the no trespassing. Maybe you can go and get arrested for the media, Tom, and just say, lay down there and get that. So that's the update on that.
Atlanta Audubon Society has recently discovered Murphy Candler Lake. There's a lot of people coming from other areas doing birding there. But some of the comments they're making are about the trash around the lake. So is there a schedule, is there a schedule to pick up trash around the lake? How does that get handled?
Well, right now we have a private contractors that go around and do maintenance on our fields, outside the fields of Murphy County. And they cut grass there once a week, but they should be picking up trash daily around the lake. Yes, ma'am.
You might not know, or you might know, again, we just commissioned a basin study. Bennett can talk about that a little bit because he was involved in it, but a basin study of the whole Murphy Candler Nancy Creek Basin. So not just of the lake. The focus is on the lake, but all the areas that flow into it. We do get a lot of refuse and runoff from outside of the city around 285 from a lot of the businesses up there. And we're looking at ways to get them involved in helping and pay for the restoration of the lake. So the study is being done now. The restoration, I think they're walking. You can actually walk with the study group, can't you?
Well, the consultants will be walking over 8 miles of creeks in the Nancy Creek watershed. But, you know, a lot of that's going to be in people's backyards and the neighborhoods. So the idea would be you want to limit who's walking to the consultants. They'll have to.
Maybe the property owners that are what we're going to
have a parade walking through.
But that to restore, dredging the lake is important in getting the trash. I mean, we're doing new trash cans and benches everywhere. And I'm aware that there's a lot of trash on the shoreline and there are frequent cleanups. I think there's one this weekend, isn't there?
Yeah.
Saturday. So Saturday, what time?
9 to 12.
9 to 12 for a trash cleanup at the lake. So you can all be there. That'd be great. I've attended several. And then they have plannings too. But one of the things that our staff, our park staff, has been working very hard on is attention to detail when it comes to the landscaping and the mowing and the cutting and the trash. So if you have areas, you can take pictures of it, show where it is, and then just send it to Parks and Rec staff. They'll get on that vendor real quick. I mean, they're very responsive. So, I cannot wait to see in a couple of years what Murphy County Lake is going to look like. It's already a jewel, but it's going to be bigger because we're going to dredge out what used to be there. Because when I was a kid, I remember the area up the north end, closer to 285, used to be lake, and now it's basically a green swamp, and it's from all the siltation. And I'm excited about what we can do to get the job done right this time. I know the county did it a few years ago, but it just didn't take. So we're very excited about that, restoring that lake.
Well, a follow up on that, the removal of the privet and stuff, is that going to happen like soon? Because another thing about Audubon Society is it's kind of nesting season, you know, the spring is the nesting season. So will that brush be cleaned out in the spring or in the summer?
We did some already, and the Conservancy was involved. There was some controversy about it. Some people, I know that the Parks Department has been in discussions with the Murphy County Park Conservancy, and that was one of their high priorities, getting rid of some of the non-native underbrush and some of the brush that was obscuring the playgrounds. Because there, if you, I don't know if you remember a few years ago when that guy who was caught up at the Valero station, who had committed the murders, he was hiding in that area that has now been cleared. So they had a forest rake that went in there, and so some of the residents were a little upset because they see the trees, but they didn't see all the undergrowth they used to see. So if you can address that, and we're going to have goats too, by the way.
Yeah.
And we do it in invasive removal, and like you said, we did upset some people, but we did it for safety reasons and clean out where the big trees, you know, the forest can grow and stay alive. So we did it for positive reasons also, but then people brought up the fact it's nesting and nesting season. This should take place probably more in the wintertime.
Do we know when
we're done?
We're done.
Yes, in the wintertime.
Except for the goats coming.
When the water brush goes away, you won't see it.
Yeah.
Goats or sheep? We have
sheep.
Goats.
Yeah,
sheep.
Should be in a couple of weeks.
And that's meant to clear out the cuts and stuff like that. Before one more question, Ronnie, then we'll get to you. After the volunteer work that the citizens do at Murphy Candler Lake. 9 to 12, don't we have events at our pools this coming Saturday?
Taylor, I got it. Taylor, athletic manager here, he's with her.
Is that
Water Safety Day?
Is that at all of our pools?
It's at Murphy Candler.
Just Murphy Candler, and then
that's not Saturday.
That's not this one.
It's not this Saturday.
Is Broadwood's going to be after that?
No, this is they're doing one. Here's the microphone.
Yeah, right there.
And then also in there, welcome to the season pool party at all the pools.
Yeah, can I see the brochure so I can give them the right dates?
You're right.
I don't know all the dates. We got so much stuff.
I think
all
right,
it's a back school party.
Yeah.
Yeah, for all the events we have coming up in the pools this summer, we do have a water safety day at Murphy Candler on Saturday, June 6th. And we're going to have music, fun, and or music, food, and fun. And there's going to be, we're going to have hot dogs and hamburgers that our pool contractor that we got this year, they're providing that as a free service to the community at Murphy Candler. So that's one event we're going to do. We're also going to have a back-to-school splash party like we did last year at all three pools. We're going to have movies and just all kinds of activities that all the families can do. And new this year, we're going to do a doggy dip day, which will be at the end of the season, obviously. And we're going to do a doggy dip day where you can bring your dogs out and we'll have contests where they can the biggest splash and the waggiest tail and all those kinds of stuff. It's going to be really kind of cool. I know you can't swim with the dogs, but that'll be a really cool event that I'm looking forward to. And then we're also going to do some dive-in movies. We have several days. We have Friday, June 19th at Briarwood, and then Friday, July 17th at Murphy Candler. So the movies haven't been officially determined yet, but that's just some cool activities we're going to do at the pools this summer. And then we also have the Briarwood Barracudas and the Murphy Candler Marlins swim teams that we're going to do. And we'll also, those teams will actually have an opportunity to go to the state swim meet, which will be down in Tipton, Georgia this year. So.
While we're on pools, I know that contracts are already signed. Is there any way to get back a 12 o'clock start on Saturday or Sunday?
Right now, I believe the reason we did that was because the expected and hopefully the amount of kids that we do have signed up for our swim teams, and I know we're obviously currently accepting swim registrations for that. So, but we pushed it back to 12 because we pushed it back, I guess, to 1 o'clock because we were hoping that we'd have a higher amount of registrations for our swim teams.
We only have three Saturday meets.
Correct, right, yeah. After we did that schedule, we changed the schedule.
Okay. My pool, sorry.
I understand. We changed that. I mean, we did during the week. I know there were some citizens that wanted more weeknights or later weeknights, so we did extend two nights during the week, but we wanted to accommodate. Also, we're going to have water, swim aerobics, swim lessons, that we will do some on Saturday mornings as well, that where there's not a swim meet.
Can we look into that though? I mean, it would be an extra cost.
Right.
But can we look into that, Jerry, about the days that there's not a swim meet? Because I do realize when I used to go to pool work when I was a kid, they opened at 11 or something, but it would make a big difference to some folks that they can bring lunch down there and have lunch and buy stuff at the pool for hot dogs at the pool for lunch. So if y'all could just look into that.
Okay.
I understand the reasons why you did it, but I think it'd be good to look into it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
What I would like to see done, the DeKalb County court system has a lot of young hoodlums that need to do community service. So instead of hearing, let's spend money and hiring people to pick up trash, why don't we get the mayor to get with the city attorney and let's put together a program of community service.
I have talked to the judges about that. It would be our judges that assigned it, and they do assign community service, and it would be helpful to have, I don't want to say we want hoodlums, but,
Hey, I was 1 year ago,
mysteries,
I know.
Maybe.
I'm a bad kid, I know. So, you pick up paper, I'm there. And one more question I've got, and just I want you just to set me straight, because I don't know. Rumor on the street that years ago, for years, and I was a Murphy County Colt. I played all through the years, I know. And all those years, I enjoyed it. I had fun. But the word is that with the baseball programs now, that the private entity that the baseball deal is used to pay for all the grass cutting out of their money. And the word is now that our city pays for it, and they don't.
No, they pay for
set the, everybody straight, or set me straight. So
the leagues, any leagues we have, whether it's the Colts or the Murphy Candler Base Little League, they pay for all the maintenance inside the fences at the park. So any field they use, they pay for all the landscaping, everything with it. And they do some stuff on the outside too. They do tree planting, but That's the contract states, anything outside of the fence, we're responsible for, anything inside of the fence, they're responsible for. So they pay their power bill too, the whole power bill.
Thank you very much.
And so they spend hundreds of thousands of dollars every year that we don't have to spend, because we, if there's a private group that does it, there's no reason for the government to get involved.
Are you doing the Ashford Park tennis courts too? You said all the others are for Ashford Park?
Yeah, Ashford Park we do.
Okay.
Mr. Sprinkle.
You said you put lights along the sidewalks and paths?
Along walking paths at Blackman.
All through inside the park?
Yes, sir.
Just a curious thing, I know most parks, that just occurred with my activity, it turned out to be more dangerous than safe to have a light.
Yeah, we're on our walking trails, and then you have, we'll have a lighting, I mean, a timer on where they go off at midnight, 11 a.m.
Or earlier. Right, yeah, there should be people in the park. They should go off when the park closes.
Right.
There are lights that I've seen that I've looked at some conventions where they're directional down. You don't see them from outside the park. But yeah, that's been a concern that was raised, that lighting the trails and the sidewalks can encourage bad activity. But in the wintertime, if it's getting dark at 6 o'clock and people want to be able to walk, and like the gentleman was stating earlier about falling down on them, we'll be very vigilant and very careful about how we time that and make sure that there's not midnight lights around the park, because you're exactly right, that's what will happen.
I would suggest that 11 o'clock is way too late.
It is. Well, the park closes at 9.
It's not that people see the lights.
11 p.m.
It's closed time?
The active park's still open until 11.
Maybe the lights are in that area.
Except during events, yeah, right.
The YMCA is open until 10, so if you want to walk from YMCA to my neighborhood on the other side of Blackburn Park, and you don't want to walk down Ashford Dunwoody, like I don't, walk the path, but it's very dark. I mean, as dark as it is in the open areas, it's way darker when you get down there, and it's, you know.
I understand that. Just the research has shown that installations of lights along isolated paths can actually increase crime.
Well, I'm sure if that happened, it could be rethunk. It's not a lifetime commitment.
Mr. Mayor, there's new technology in lighting out there that the lights will only come on if it detects people. Okay. So they don't have to stay on all the time.
That would be good.
With the inroads and LED.
Motion activated.
Yeah, LED will reduce the cost and everything. So there's a lot of.
Phillips makes a good product. I saw one of their display booths. Yeah.
And a homegrown company here called Acuity.
Acuity?
Acuity brand.
Acuity. Look at that for that. You own Acuity?
I own Acuity. Full disclosure.
Yes, Jesus.
Are there any plans to put any benches on the east side of the park, any bathrooms on the east side of the park? And on the wooden bridges, they are very slick when they're damp. Is there any way that we could put some strips so you don't slip when you go down?
Reboard the bridges, yeah, those.
Yeah, just, you just go spray something and throw sand on it, and that'd be good.
Well, they are benches kind of.
Oh, for the east, right. But I mean, like along the trail, deep right. Into the trail.
I don't know if we put them deep into the trail, like in the very end.
Well, when you come, there's.
This guy's talking. You get people hanging out there too long.
No, you don't. That'd be a great place to sit and read a book. I mean, there's a place that overlooks a really high hill that overlooks part of that area. There's actually probably lake, and I would, you know, I'm there every day, and I'm thinking, man, what a great place to come sit and read a book, because it's
right. We have more benches, things coming.
Okay.
Any more? Well, yes, over here. If you haven't had a question first. Okay.
Oh.
All right. We are late. We have to move along. We got.
Very important to the environmental health of the region. It traps pollution, for example, unless the pollutants biodegrade naturally. Several other things as well. So you need to be very careful about
that. Yeah, I know some of it's got to stay. There's just an area closer to the lake that has been filled in. But yeah, absolutely, you have to have that filter at the top, at the headwater.
Yes,
of the lake.
Okay. Yes.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Ben Song, there he is.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Ben Song, and I have the pleasure of overseeing community development. Just to give you a quick overview of community development, we deal with building permits, sign ordinances, code enforcement, zoning, I'm sure everyone's familiar with zoning and a lot of the different issues that we've reviewed through the almost close to 2 years of cityhood. With that said, with the interest of time, I'll quickly go over sort of the key aspects that we're dealing with right now. We've have put out an RFP to rewrite the zoning ordinance. As you may be aware, when we came into cityhood, we adopted DeKalb County's zoning ordinance. And again, DeKalb County's zoning ordinance regulated land uses on a larger area, obviously the county. It's not tailored to what we deal with, and that's what's unique to the city. In particular to the unique aspects that we find between, if you were to use Petrie as sort of the dividing line between the north and the south, development patterns are greatly different in, depending on where you may be residing. With that said, we have awarded it to Duncan Associates, and Duncan Associates has done a lot of work with DeKalb County and Sandy Springs. Very innovative, very progressive, but they have helped out those jurisdictions that are dealing with the same issues that we are dealing with in terms of growth and zoning issues that you may be seeing in development overall. That would be, we're preparing the contract to bring that before the City Council for their formal approval. Hopefully we'll be able to see that in July. As part of the initiative for community development as well, we've been tasked by the council to perform sort of education sessions for the community and for the residents, as well as builders and developers on a quarterly basis. Thus far, through the Builder and Developer Summit, we have gone over land disturbance permit process, as well as the building permit process. We also had the first Brookhaven 101, again, it's more of an educational course provided to residents. And the first, I believe, meeting dealt with, again, permitting, just to give everyone a better overview of the permitting process. The upcoming Builder and Developer Summit and Brookhaven 101 actually will take place on the same day. We're scheduling that for Thursday, June 11th. The Builder and Developer Summit, again, in both sessions, we'll be discussing zoning, giving everyone the overview of how zoning matters are reviewed in terms of the staff's perspective, as well as from the perspective of council, the different ordinances that come into play. As you may be aware, in November, we adopted our own comprehensive plan, no longer relying on DeKalb County, so we have a better idea in terms of how we want to grow in the future for the next 20 years. And we're looking to sort of share those informations to the residents, and also better educate folks in terms of what is involved in the overall scheme of reviewing zoning requests. Brookhaven 101, again, is more tailored towards the residents. Again, that'll be scheduled for Thursday, June 11th. And actually, we made a change. Usually, we held it during the day, but we felt that a lot of folks weren't able to attend just because, again, everyone's out and working. But we decided to hold those meetings in the evening, and we have scheduled it from 6 to 8 p.m. So, that's my presentation. If you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them.
All right.
Yes, sir.
I would like to respectfully request that you schedule a session for the community to educate you on what we would like to see in terms of zoning, because right now it is so disappointing to see that we seem to be just doing what we've always done, which is tear down the trees and pack as much as we can.
Sure, and I totally understand, and I would appreciate if you would attend the Brookhaven 1 meeting that's coming up on June 11th. That's exactly what we'll be going over. And it's a time for where we receive input from the residents. At the same time, we want to also share where we're coming from in terms of our review. Our review, again, we're tasked to enforce the ordinances that are in place, the comprehensive plan that's in place. The larger discussion overall is that's the overall aspect of public meetings, and that's what we have in place. As part of any rezoning request, we go through two public meetings, the first being the Planning Commission, their recommending body to the City Council, and lastly, it would be City Council, who would have the overall, the final decisions of any zoning legislative matter that comes before the city. But again, I would invite you to attend. Oh, I totally understand. And hopefully that's reflected over the comprehensive plan, and some of it was captured. Some of it is just a greater dialogue needs to be held between, again, the residents and the city. And as part of any process, we welcome any sort of comments, input that you may have through any zoning request that does come through the city. On our website, we do share all zoning requests, variance requests that are upcoming. That's available on the website, so you have the ability to review. And we can take any input, and what we do with any input that we receive as part of the packet that we send out a week prior to any meeting, we share that with the council.
I guess I'd like to just see a level set that is much more restrictive at the baseline so that we as the residents of the community don't have to monitor every single application. The same discussion over and over and usually not winning.
I'll address a little bit of that. There is, we had a comprehensive plan that was had wide community input, and a lot of the things that are in it came from the community. We've adjusted it, and part of the zoning ordinance rewrite, we're going to want more community input with that. There are things we need to tweak, because every zoning ordinance and every code we had, we inherited from DeKalb County. And that was a countywide zoning ordinance, a countywide comprehensive plan. So we're part of this is learning and making sure that our zoning and our ordinances reflect what our citizens want. I ran on neighborhood protection of neighborhoods. I mean, I think you saw some of that last night with the Oak Forest, the townhome rejection, because R100 preserving our neighborhoods is very important. We have disagreements on other zoning issues among council, amongst ourselves, and there's other things we agree on. But no, we've denied plenty of things, but we have to always be, this is something we've all learned, we have to be very, very careful. We talk about more restrictive zoning codes. Yes, we can tweak edges here and there, but when you're dealing with property rights, you're dealing with vested property rights. And it's a balancing between the rights of the people that actually own the property and the rights of the neighborhoods surrounding it and what effect that development might have. So it's to be all one way or the other is difficult, because you end up in lawsuit after lawsuit after lawsuit. We don't legislate, we don't make decisions based on whether we're gonna get sued, but you have to have a practical understanding of vested property rights to make sure that you're not denying someone's use of their property by just saying no to everything. We need to say no, and you need to be vigilant as citizens when applications come through. That's part of being an active citizen and protecting your neighborhood. Like I said Tuesday night, we have a great thing here. Other people want to get in on it. They want to get a part of what you have. And it's your duty as residents, as ours as elected officials, to protect what you have and not let that be destroyed, because the reason that we all live here is because we have great residential neighborhoods inside the perimeter, close to the amenities downtown and other areas. That is the reason, you know, we have a little forest inside of a city just about in some places. So it's a very difficult thing to do, and something we've all learned, both sides of that argument. There just needs to be a moderate balance in the middle, I think. And I think we've tried to do that, maybe not in every decision, in every instance, but.
If you look at that development right now that's going on now, where the Korean Baptist Church was, my neighbors across the street back up to that. And then there's condominiums on the other side of it.
At Denver
Those
Park.
People all have had to have taken huge hits on their property values. My one neighbor across the street, there's no way she could put her house on the market and not just completely take a bath, because what was a really cute house in a nice setting with lovely wooded, you know, lot behind her now is just absolutely barren, and it's really sad.
Well, there may be a hit issue right now, but I think once that development is complete, it changes the picture, because they're going to have to replant. It's going to be a nice looking little neighborhood there, and I think that'll increase her property values in the long run. It always looks bad when somebody scrapes a lot or does something. We have a tree ordinance we're working on tweaking to soften the edges of that and make sure that we preserve our canopy. That's something we're working on, because our tree ordinance was the calves. We thought we made a stronger one. We did in many ways, and we're tweaking it again with help from residents. And I hope you can, there's a tree ordinance group right now, is there not?
And there's some members here tonight. So the thing is, yes, we're continuously wanting dialogue with the public. I understand the frustration that you do have. It's a matter of sometimes, again, maybe not having the answers or not having your questions answered correctly. But again, I'm open to have any discussion that you would like to hold.
Well, it's not a question of not understanding.
And I understand your opinion.
Sure.
I understand your opinion. Some of the other questions. We can always discuss, and I'll be more than happy to discuss that with you.
Mayor, what you said about vested property rights on Tuesday, I've yet to get an explanation from the staff or the city council, so I basically have a two-part question with respect to Ashford Green, how they walked in asking for 750. They had a vested property right in 750,000 square feet, and they walked out with 1.1 million, and I have yet to hear anyone explain why the city rolled over on that, and nobody in this room was for that. So,
well, that's the balance that's talking about.
Yeah, it's great balance. I would like to
I can address that a little bit for you. I had an issue with the volume of the square footage, but you know, that's a I don't get a vote on that.
Staff was supporting that already before the city council even voted.
We don't always agree with staff either.
But they did. They did.
Sure. And as you may be well aware, we recommended approval for Oak Forest. That was denied. Again, that's the fact that, again, what we're reviewing,
so you know, have we ever denied one?
Excuse me, sir. The only item that, just, I'll address this question first and then I'll get to yours if you don't mind. When we're reviewing it based upon the comprehensive plan. Again, the original intent and when the original application was submitted, we're working under the confines of DeKalb County's comprehensive plan, which looked at and allowed for density or recommended or even recommended as a policy for the overall density within the perimeter summit area up to 120 units per acre. When we're talking about the overall square footage, and I know that's what you're referring to, the 1.13, when we're looking in terms of the planning field, when you're looking at the overall density of a property, the density is separated between residential and commercial. I understand the articles that have gone out are lumping those square footages together. Generally speaking, with any development, with a mixed-use development in particular, when we're looking at density, we are separating commercial density from residential density in terms of the overall calculation.
Why didn't you have them go down on their commercial density if you're going to allow them to add another 400,000 square feet?
Again, we're working under the United Growth Policy Map that was established by ARC that has been incorporated through our comprehensive plan. That was also reviewed as an LCI plan for the perimeter area as a whole, which does include the southern section of perimeter center, you can say, which is the northern part of the city for us, which is an economic engine. However, we're not necessarily taking that into place. We're taking into place the policies that are in place, the zonings that are in place, the previous studies that were done, evidence of development to take place. If there was any dense development to go through, that would be the location that's ideal. But we're working, again, based upon land uses, that's what we look at in terms of our analysis, comprehensive plan, and overall existing land uses that are existing in the area. And that's how we came to our conclusion from staff's perspective.
I don't think we can change the decision Tuesday night.
Yes, sir.
And we'd like to go back and revisit it. From an economic standpoint, to have a company like John Hancock in our community is fantastic. But there was a lot of confusion from what I saw, even amongst the council, as to what that team came in and asked for. To the point where we heard some discussion saying, well, I'm kind of confused at what you want. Do you want 27,000 extra square feet? Plus 300,000 extra square feet. Mm-hmm. And it was like watching Congress. And sure. Waiting for someone to say, well, we got to pass the bill first, then we'll read what's inside it.
Yeah. And that's so, actually what happened. It was approved, and then people started saying, I'm really concerned that there's an extra 400,000 square feet. We're sitting there asking, why didn't you ask that question before you approved it?
Before staff approved it?
Yeah, before the city council.
I asked that question before.
I know, Mayor, but the question was asked after.
Right. Again, one thing to clear up, and again, I can't sort of explain the complicated aspects of that overall development. From DeKalb County, the original zoning that took place, again, which allowed for three buildings up to 18 stories, up to total square footage of 750,000 square feet. When DeKalb went about zoning it, they mentioned 750,000 square feet net usable space. Does it make a major difference? It may not. I mean, when we discussed it during the council meeting, we talked about what is the percentage of the property that may be equated to the non-usable area to the gross square footage. It could be anywhere from 10 to 15 feet. We may, at the end of the day, if we were to add up all the numbers, we're close. We may be slightly over, I don't disagree with you, but we are close to what they were initially approved for. What we got in return, I understand we got 300 units of residential use, but we have gotten effectively lower buildings. Essentially, we have more control over in terms of the conditions, because there's a lot of conditions that were, well, at that time, they didn't necessarily tack on a lot of conditions. But what we're asking for, and then in terms of the overall aesthetics, we were able to put more local control over the development as a whole. And that's something that, again, I want to share during the Brookhaven 101. Different aspects of rezoning and how we could go be an integral part of the rezoning process. Yes, there are going to be developments and projects that you may not agree with. But there are times when we are able to develop and create better developments through the aspect of conditioning and condition or approval by conditions.
We hope that happens.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
You gonna wait? You wanna go?
Go ahead. I won't ask six questions.
Okay, I won't ask six questions, but I want to say thank you so much because you said you understand the song and what he's saying, and you felt kind of condescending how he talked to you. I have felt that.
That's what I did.
Yes, we kind of referred that. I have felt that way multiple times. That being said, a lot of it is zoning.
Absolutely.
And one thing that, as elected officials, you're supposed to protect our interests. It is not, has to be, if you did a comprehensive plan, which was to maintain the neighborhoods as they were, but then you say, oh, but we have to have personal property rights, and then the zoning. I know a half a block from where I live, all the trees were ripped down. Legally, it's not a clear cut, but basically, we did the calculations, and it's less than 1% of the trees left, of old growth forest, gone. 100 years. So.
Well, it was well below what the current tree ordinance.
And the tree ordinance.
The tree ordinance allows, but it's approved by an administrator.
I will say, I think that there's some stats on those trees that I think there were 100 and something trees, and I think a good portion were diseased.
A few were diseased.
Well, I think a third were diseased.
I don't mean to be disrespectful. Please let me finish. The tree ordinance that we adopted from DeKalb County was stronger for the majority of the trees than it is now. It has been weakened. And yes, you're working on it right now. I want real grit for this tree ordinance so trees will really be protected. Not when zoning, the ZBA and the council can vote against it. We need true protection because our neighborhoods are being changed, and the comprehensive plan was to keep our neighborhoods the same, and they're not being the same. And yes, you can replant, and yes, you can put more grass down, but it's not the same. And I need y'all to hear that. And I think that's what a few people over here are saying. We have someone from the Audubon Society. When you have big 100-year-old trees, birds are nesting in that, animals are nesting in it, and tons of insects. But those are being ripped down. And I will say, I live right off of North Druid Hills. And I'll be really quick, sir. I live right off of North Druid Hills. I walked that property when they cut down all the trees, and I was shocked to see all the birds crying for their homes. And some of y'all might laugh at me for that, which is fine. But to me, that broke my heart. And when I heard someone say that it was a getting rid of the eyesore on North Druid Hills, that made me become an activist, which I've never been before. That's all I have to say.
And it is property value. Yes.
Yes?
It does go to our property values. I experienced the same thing. It has to do everything with zoning. The Buckhead Preserve came in, and they rezoned that and cleared every tree off that lot, that big parcel of land, and then came in and said that they would leave trees, and they damaged them to the point that they're dying now. The biggest one on the corner there on Shady Valley, which is no longer shady for those living in the Buckhead Preserve. They walk into our neighborhood for that shade. And my property, the lot next door to me, they're removing all of the trees in the back, with the exception of a few which they've been damaged. And then I have the development up the street. What are y'all going to do? How are you going to address the stormwater? Because I have hydrostatic stormwater damage on my personal property as a result of what's been permitted. So how are y'all going to address our natural stormwater system that we have with our 100, 200-year-old oaks that last a long time, as opposed to
the detention ponds that you're putting in at the top of the street.
I'd like to know about the, if somebody has damaged your property as a result of something they've done with, we were talking about stormwater.
I sent you a certified letter.
Okay, well, that's you have civil, there's civil liability there on the part of the developer. They diverted the flow of water to make it that your property is now flooding, so.
But aside from that, my point is it has everything to do with your personal property. I have a gigantic wall that's 6 feet from my house now. 6 feet. It's a mountain of water that pours off of it. It's running down the side of my property line. That was allowed. That's what happens when you remove your trees, is you no longer have that natural stormwater system that was meant to be there. And a retention pond takes money. The city has to spend money on it. HOAs have to maintenance that. And if it doesn't get well maintained, it becomes a problem for the city. And what happens then? Our tax dollars go up.
I can address one thing on the
The retention pond issue, we have addressed that, because that was one of the first things that we were made aware of, that there are several retention ponds in the city that have not been maintained, that we inherited, and we have a scheme in place to make sure that they are.
Well, how is that being addressed up the street on Goodwin Road, where all the trees that Sally just referred to were all clear cut? And the whole property's been regraded, all the original soil, the replantings aren't gonna work as well. The little 2.5 foot saplings are gonna give the city back pennies worth of stormwater protection that those oaks that were there before did, and those will last 100 to 200 years, whereas a retention pond is 50.
I'm just gonna briefly touch on the stormwater issue. The city is currently, we've instructed staff to start looking at stormwater retention ordinance for even single family home construction so that they can, right now they do it, I think, as a policy. We're talking about making that an ordinance so that stormwater retention is specific to every property built.
But we have it in our trees, and the EPA.
But the second thing is that on stormwater, the city has now we've set up a restricted fund that the stormwater fees that are paid in your water bill actually go to the city of Brookhaven. It's a restricted fund that is used specifically to address the maintenance and improvements of our stormwater retentions. So, and with Cab County, that those fees were being collected, but there was no restricted fund.
Right.
We actually asked them, what's the balance of the stormwater fund when we created the city, and it was zero.
Right. But the EPA advises against the retention ponds.
Ben, did you have any final comments?
Oh, no, I just wanted to follow up again. As part of sort of the discussion with tree ordinances, what we did implement in terms of a rezoning process, we're asking folks to submit a tree survey as part of the existing condition, so that could be correctly taken into account as part of a rezoning request.
Yes, Mr. Rowe. Yes.
I want to make an observation on the basic zoning process as well as a question at the end. And I want to compare the Hastings project that's recently been looked at versus another Walgreens project that's approved. I've been to more of those Walgreens projects than I care to remember, and partly the cab, and then later after Brookhaven inherited it. After about 5 or 6 years of very contentious meetings, on the ultimate day that the ZBA was going to approve that project, during the day, the zoning attorney that's presenting that case that night is allowed to educate the ZBA on the finer points of what they need to be ruling on. And then later that night, he was presenting an applicant trying to get an approval for a very contentious project, which did get approved with 9 variances approved, all of them variances against the overlay, which have been in place for quite a while. It took about 12 years of effort to get that zoning code approved. Not so long ago, across the street at the Hastings project, there was a 100% overlay compliant project that was put forward, and there was significant pressure by about 4 or 5 homeowners behind the project, and that got scuttled. And, you know, it did seem like there was a fair application of the zoning code there. And the applicant withdrew because he didn't think he was going to get support for that project. So the first observation is, can there be some reform of the ZBA process so that you never again have a zoning attorney educating people that are going to be ruling on his applicant that same night? That can never happen again. That doesn't pass the smell test at all. And then secondly, you guys are talking about reform of the zoning code. That overlay is a product of about 12 years of elbow grease. And I hear you guys saying we're going to tweak it, and there's been articles in the paper about we need to make some changes around the edges of it. Be very cautious when you do that, because you guys don't nearly have as much time and skin in the game for that cook. I know you said you adopted it, but every one of you sitting at that table is an elected official campaign in support of the overlay, every single one. So now that you're coming back and saying we're going to review, we're going to tweak, just be cautious and go slow with that.
Yeah, I think we are. That's a good point. There are some issues that do need to be tweaked with the OA. Nothing that affects the overall intent and effect of it. But we've had some issues because of just, for example, baseball was the one issue we had about some of the parking requirements. It's creating trouble on Dresden and Caldwell. Some things are severely underparked. Not that you want a lot more parking, but I think the restaurant that was going to go on the corner at Caldwell and of Caldwell, something like 20 parking spaces for a restaurant, and it's those type of issues that we want to bring the community back for any tweaks we do, and I think the tweaks we have done have been in concert with the community. I know we've done a few things. I don't know how much more there is, but we'll rely on our citizens and our staff and council to figure out what needs to be done, and we'll be very cautious, and you will know about it before it happens, and you'll have plenty of chance to weigh in on it.
I
appreciate the work that we're doing.
Let me state that I am a huge supporter of Brookhaven Peachtree Overlay. There was a tremendous amount of community involvement in creating that that plan that started out as the Brookhaven LCI study and then became the overlay. One of the things that I tell a lot of people is look, the overlay is not just a set of laws. It's a design vision for what the citizens of Brookhaven want to see in our commercial corridor, Peachtree Road and Dresden Drive. Now, when we have developments come before us and it meets the letter of the law of the overlay and says, look, this is exactly what your law says you want to see built here, and yet it has tremendous opposition from the public. And I can tell you, historic Brookhaven was not just a small number of houses. A neighborhood association was very much activated over the opposition to that development. Now, right or wrong, there is an education process that needs to take place where we need to really do a better job of laying this thing out on the table and saying, hey, maybe you didn't get a part in the original overlay design plans, but now's your second chance. Let's get engaged and let's talk about the design vision of our commercial corridor on Peachtree Road, because that is, I believe, particularly for District 3, the cultural heart of the city of Brookhaven, and it's an area that we want to be proud of, so that we can put out there to the development community, here's the overlay. We all signed off on this as a city, and if you meet the letter of the law and come forward with plans that meet this overlay, we're going to champion your project, and that's what we want to see.
Respectfully, I hear what you're saying, but if we look back at the Walgreens decision, there was equal or more opposition from my neighborhood, Brookhaven Heights. And despite that, huge amount of opposition, it got approved after 7 years of contention.
Yeah.
And the significant and very awkward variances got approved.
Look, I'd say a lot of the same arguments can be used for the Ashford Green development and the comprehensive plan. The comprehensive plan is essentially the guiding document up there on that zoning, and you had a lot of people said, well, we didn't want that. We don't think that was smart urban design planning. So you're always going to have opposition to development and zoning cases. The best that we can do is engage our public, put forward plans that make sense and have good urban design planning behind them, and then support those plans. And that's what we're charged to do as a council.
And then one last question. Regarding the ZBA appointments and the kind of thing where that occurred on the night of the Walgreens approval, what is the process for removing somebody from the ZBA? Can it be done? How does it happen? Because that seemed like they were all arm's length and removed from accountability, the way that was handled.
Sure. Yeah. Let's answer that.
Yeah, the ZBA is appointed by the mayor, and then when their appointments expire, can reappoint or not reappoint.
But you have to wait till the term expires, you can't.
Well, I mean, no, if there's some kind of egregious or malevolent behavior, yeah, you can move them, yes.
There actually was, I know, in a different either county or city in Atlanta, there was a lawsuit on either the county or city trying to remove a ZBA or planning commission person, and they sued in the city. They sued the city and won because you have to have cause to remove somebody from their term. But look, these, I also would contend that as our city started, we had a, this elected body, our ZBA, our planning commission, all had very little experience in doing this. We're a brand new city. There's a learning curve to that process. And there's a lot of value in experience. We're now a much more experienced elected body. Our planning commission and ZBA are both more experienced in what they do. And we're not perfect, and I'll never contend that we're a perfect organization, but hopefully we learn from our mistakes.
Thank you. One more, Neil?
Yeah, I want to say, since we're on the topic of the overlay, there's talk of addressing transitional areas, and specifically the lots that are on Caldwell, not just the ones directly behind the DMV, but also the ones further down in the neighborhood. How exactly do you plan to address that? With all due respect to the champions of the overlay, you know, 80% of the overlay is great, much like 80% of everything else, but we do have to fine tune stuff. And there's not going to be an apartment complex being built facing Caldwell. That's just not going to happen. So how are you folks going to address that?
Probably, I don't think we can prejudge an issue, but I certainly wouldn't be in favor of apartments, you know, across 50 feet away from a single family.
I appreciate that, but we you just said you didn't get a vote. So, so as much as I love hearing that, thank you.
Yeah, as it
comes, I think what I've heard, sorry to interrupt you, what I've heard is, you know, we're making decisions based on ordinances or guidelines that are put in place, right? So this is the time, because we're seeing an almost maniacal rush to really high density. And to your point, Bates, if there's a learning curve, then maybe it's a good time to step back and slow things down a little bit. With all due respect to the developers, if the money's there to be made today, it'll be there to be made maybe an extra 30 days from now, so that we look at things and really examine them the way they need to be addressed.
Well, I'll say a couple points on that. One is, as was pointed out, the LCI process started 12 years ago. So it is a process that's gone through multiple iterations, and we actually are now talking about doing an update to the LCI, because the ARC, the Atlanta Regional Commission, calls for updating these LCI studies every 10 years. So it's not just a brand new city taking a look at these processes. They were in place way before the city existed. The second part is that there are some things that when we designed the LCI that weren't really taken into account, that I don't think it got specific enough, and when you put it in practice, sometimes it doesn't work. I think we saw that when you looked at the Caldwell Road rezoning, where there was a single home, an R100 or an R85, that they wanted to design to the overlay standards. Well, overlay standards would have allowed, and I think that was considered sub-area 1, or was it sub-area 2?
Sub-area 2.
Sub-area 2, so you get up to, you know, with height bonuses, you could have had a 6-story building on a single-family home lot. Well, that's really probably not appropriate when you're right next to a single-family home. But it's hard when you're going through those plans to say, you know, to actually foresee every one of those situations. I think we've learned somewhat from those situations being brought to light, but we don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. Those are exceptions, not the norm, and I think there's a lot of good design planning behind the LCI that was done, which is now the overlay.
But Anil, just to add to that, we are looking into possibly amending the boundaries of the overlay. I don't know if that's been shared with BBCA. And we'll reach out, and I've been in discussion with other folks within BPC about that specifically. We're talking about just the boundaries, nothing else in particular to the actual requirements or standards related to the overlap, just to certain input that we receive from the residents, and that's gonna be going before a public hearing. One thing to sort of point out, in particular that property, they do currently have zoning entitlements that you're referring to. It was zoned PC2 in 2006 through DeKalb County. They do have entitlements for a mixed-use development that they currently have now. That's 9 years old, but you know, with any zoning that takes place, it does run with the life of the property. So with that said, that's what we have in place.
Unless we change it.
Unless there was a rezoning action that was to take place and take that away.
I think something worth considering, because when that was issued in 2006, 1377 didn't exist, and
Brookhaven
didn't exist, and we weren't on the cusp of everything that's going to happen at the Marist School. So, you know, and I appreciate the answer. This is going to be a long night if we go back and forth, but my question to you, Ben, is how do we submit, how do those of us who are in those affected areas submit particular slices of that for consideration in the transition to be removed, so to speak, from the ability to do a 3 to 6 story apartment complex?
Essentially, in this particular case, it would be zoning, that's one. Two, it's, again, we're going back to the discussion of redefining the boundaries of the overlay. That may be sort of the start. And where we begin is to start from the ordinance. Again, that section of the overlay is subarea 2. The maximum height is four stories, 60 feet. Again, it's a little bit different just because that the uniqueness of that property is surrounded by, it fronts on right away. So technically there is no transitional buffer per se that has to be applied. But again,
it would be good to have single family across from single family on that, because it's literally, it's not even 50 feet from your front yard.
It's 20 feet.
20 feet, yeah.
The street is 20 feet. It's smaller than a 24 foot street. At four stories, would be 60 feet.
Yeah.
And on our side, the maximum height residentially is 35 feet.
That's correct.
Just imagine that, right? So, but we do need
I don't see it happening.
Yeah, we do need a transition. And I think the key there is to tweak it. No one's talking about throwing out the baby with the bathwater.
Right.
We don't want that. But we do need to recognize where it needs to be tweaked. You know, Camille has three townhomes on it that transition really nicely between Camille and that little village strip.
Right.
And something like that could do well.
Right.
It's just a question of us being able to look at it and say, wow, this really is 9 years old. It's time for you to go, buddy.
Yeah, there's opportunities, and there's also some interest that may be coming up. And that's the thing, that entire process, that development that you're referring to, Village Brookhaven, that actually was done through rezoning. And that was a development plan that was initiated through rezoning, that was approved, and those are the towns that you got that transitions better to what's existing there. And again, if a zoning process was to come about, that's the idea of the public hearing process, where we do have the input from the residents to sort of better design the overall feel and look of the development that is brought before you.
Thank you, Ben.
You just said the key, if a rezoning were to come about, right now that entitlement's there, someone could come along and ask for a building permit as is, and we couldn't stop it, could we?
Yes, you could.
Just quickly, we're definitely looking into that situation right now.
Okay, one more question on the community, because we have like 10 minutes left, and I guess we're going to have to cut out the council member comments.
Well, Mayor, but, if you don't mind, there's just two.
Okay, go ahead. Let's just real quick, and then yeah, he's got a short one.
I know we're running late, and I want to thank all of you for actually taking the time to listen to us and our concerns on this. It's really appreciated. I have one quick question.
One quick question, and it involved that redevelopment of the office space up in Ashford Dunwoody. A traffic study had to be done before the first proposal was put in. Was the traffic study redone after they increased the size?
At that time, when it submitted for the rezoning, we had no requirement for a traffic study to be provided. We have made changes now where we have certain trip generations. If they meet a threshold, they need to produce a traffic study or a trip generation report. Unfortunately, at that time, just due to the relative newness of the city, we did not have those requirements in place.
Understood.
What we do have as in terms of a condition as approval, they are to produce a traffic study as part prior to their land disturbance permit, which is pretty much the permit before that they need to receive in order to develop on the property. Any improvements that are recommended through the traffic study will be implemented at time of LDP.
Okay.
If they do not implement it, then we will not approve the LDP.
Okay, my only statement was going to be, with the traffic the way it is right now in Ashford Dunwoody, just trying to get up to Peachtree is becoming a nightmare, even with the improvements that they put in at Ashford Dunwoody and Johnson. So,
when is our, hey Bennett, when is our traffic study on Ashford Dunwoody due to be completed?
Talking about the Ashford Dunwoody corridor,
yes.
That will be an effort that will probably take about 10 to 12 months from when it's kicked off. And then the kickoff will The current schedule will probably occur in July.
But we've bid it out?
The requests for qualifications have gone out.
Okay.
We'll have a preliminary conference with the responders in early June. And then we expect we would come before council in July, actually, with a proposed contract.
All right. Thank you. Ma'am?
No question, just a comment. As you discussed tweaking some of the ordinances, I'd like to specifically discuss the tree ordinance. I believe that I represent a different constituency than the majority of the people in this room. I actually support the tree ordinance as it's written. I think it's restrictive. I think it's fair. And I just want to go on record to say that to you all. I think I'm part of a silent majority. This is a hot topic for my colleagues, my friends, my neighbors. I've been a resident of Brookhaven since 2003. I'm also the principal of a local residential development firm. So I see both sides of it. I'm your neighbor. So I care very deeply about these trees. I want to applaud the city arborist. She does a phenomenal job with us, helping us come up with creative solutions. We relocate trees. We switch houses. We move houses. We try so hard to save the canopy. So I want to applaud her for that and make sure that you guys know that efforts are being made on the development side to save these trees. But there have been suggestions, you know, in the rumor mill around the tree world of adopting pieces of the Atlanta Tree Ordinance. And I want to go on record saying that I just think that's such a bad idea in terms of property rights and property rights infringement. I think that we all are benefiting from what's happening in Brookhaven. You know, and there was a reference to a maniacal race to high density, and I don't think that, I've never gotten the impression that that was Brookhaven's goal. I believe that the development is a response to the demand. People want to be in Brookhaven. So I just want to go on record as a representing a different constituency. So thank you for your time.
Thank you. Yes.
Can I make a very quick comment? I would just like to go back to the first comment that was made, and I hope that you all understand that the tone and tenor from this direction, this direction, is that there's a disconnect. So as you're going through fixing the zoning ordinance, please, I think back to the first comment that was made, we want you to recognize that there's a disconnect. Something's not connecting between what the people. I mean, I sat there and watched Ashford Green, and not a single resident, not a single person who lives in Brookhaven stood up and said, we want this. Instead, there was a stream of people saying, don't do these apartments, and then it's approved. So that's a huge disconnect. Totally understand property rights. I'm a lawyer. I totally understand that. But what I want as a taxpayer is I want you to put the toughest zoning law you can, the constitutional one, in place. And then you know what? Sometimes I want you to pay the lawyers to go to court and fight it because I want you to stand up for it. Mm-hmm. So and I'm sorry to sound so abrupt. I feel like the last few times I've talked to you guys have sounded really abrupt. But I hope you recognize the theme of all these comments is that we're not connected between the residents and the council.
And quickly, I think you bring up a very good point. And as part of the zoning rewrite process, it's going to be like the comprehensive plan. We are encouraging public input.
Right.
We ask the contractor, the vendor, to also provide a website that will give continuous updates as to the process of the zoning rewrite. Again, we haven't started the process yet, but once we get it rolling, the public will be made aware. We're going to have multiple meetings. We're going to have a steering committee, very similar to the comprehensive plan, so that we could get as much input and feedback as the residents are willing to share with us, that we could actually incorporate it and develop an ordinance that definitely tailors to the needs, to the wishes, to the desires of the city.
Please join the steering committee.
I would love to.
Everybody, that's how you get changes. I mean, we had a bunch of people on the steering committees for all this stuff. Sometimes these things are, when you hear from community, they want some things, then that's what the council does. And you need to have your views represented on the steering committee. That's why we have them.
And it's great to have this meeting because I think there's a theme. And a lot of comments, there's a theme.
Sure. And right. Before I walk off, I would like to apologize to you if I was condescending. I apologize, that was never my intent. But again, I'm more than welcome and open to have discussions with you. I'm open for any suggestions you do have, and again, I welcome everyone here and encourage everyone to attend Brookhaven 101 on June 11th. Thank you.
Thank you. Hopefully, you've got to. You got to hurry because we're done. I hope so.
All right, I'll try to be quick. Earlier tonight, you heard from a couple of our consultants that are
undertaking a major effort on two areas that come out of Public Works, the North Fork Peachtree Creek Greenway Master Plan and the pedestrian bike and trail plan. There is also one other major effort that's underway that the mayor alluded to earlier, and that is the Murphy Cameron Lake Maintenance Plan and Nancy Creek Watershed Plan that's underway. The consultant is Sustainable Water Planning and Engineering. All three of these plans were kicked off last month. Sustainable Water Planning Engineering is in the early stages, as both consultants are, in gathering data from Brookhaven and adjacent communities where the data from the adjacent communities is relevant to their effort. Sustainable Water Planning Engineering will be out walking streams, 8 miles of streams within the city. They've already started to collect data. So if you encounter them, please facilitate that. And they are beginning their public outreach effort where they'll certainly be looking for input from the public and what the public would like to see occur at Murphy Cameron Lake, what issues the public has with the watershed performance, what do you see as problems, positives, desires, all that. But we're not all about just planning, big planning efforts. We're also about everyday efforts such as removing downed trees from the right-of-way, fixing potholes, responding to requests to make sure signalization is operating correctly.
Cutting
grass, that's absolutely correct. We've had a few requests, special requests for that we've jumped on lately. And then later on this summer, you'll see some of the other major efforts occur when you'll see the paving crews out, the crews building sidewalks. That effort's going to physically be seen summer and proceeding into the fall. We'll be undertaking 11 miles of paving, represented in an estimated cost of about $1.7 million, about $1.9 million of sidewalk construction and improvements. We'll be installing rapid flashing beacons at three existing crosswalks on Dresden. We'll be looking at if a rapid flashing beacon is warranted at, I believe it's Briarwood and Briarwood Way. That's some of what you'll also see occurring later on this year. We expect to undertake and complete the first wave of paving projects in mid to late summer, and the first wave of sidewalk projects late summer to fall. The sidewalk projects in particular, I want to just call your attention, they will vary in complexity and magnitude of effort from projects that can be very simply undertaken to projects that are going to require more extensive planning, more interaction with the public. A couple I can cite that you might be familiar with would be the sidewalk project that's been identified to go down Cardiquet, the sidewalk project that's been identified to go down Caldwell, will involve some public involvement as we go about the planning of how to implement those sidewalk improvements. We also continue to maintain and improve stormwater infrastructure in the city. We respond to emergency repairs, such as replacing a failed pipe. One effort that's underway that just started today on Sunland Drive. There was a sinkhole that has developed very recently in Sunland Drive, and crew is out today starting the effort to repair a pipe that was the reason why that sinkhole developed. We expect, as an example of the projects we undertake, that will be completed by early next week so that the road can be reopened and travel can occur. If I can cut you short for 1 second, before you finish, is anybody here that has specific paving or sidewalks or potholes that they wanted to talk about tonight?
Yes.
Okay, let's just get to that first.
Okay.
Just so we're out of time.
I just want to know why, when they have just paved the street, and we think great, we're done, we can enjoy it for at least a couple of years. 2 months later, they managed to find a reason to dig and install some project.
You're talking about Donaldson? Yes. The Cab County did some water work there, and it's still in a horrible shape. They're supposed to fix what they did. There's divots, and it's horrible. And that's something I've been hearing about. And I drive over it every day when I go to the office. So if we could look at that, the Blair Circle and the Donaldson wood stream,
yes.
Horrible. They did, dug it out. The county came, dug it out, and then when they repatched or paved it, it was just a comical circus looking, it's horrible.
And just to let you know, as to provide hope, some encouragement that this be resolved, DeKalb County hosts regular, I guess they're about quarterly meetings with public works directors throughout DeKalb County. So we just had one this week, and there was the, I think, acting or interim, either assistant director or director of watershed management. He gave me his contact information as a person to contact for those issues. So DeKalb County is reaching out to us and other communities in the county to help facilitate resolving this issue. Just wanted you to know.
Bennett, there's a specific request I know of from somebody in the audience here. Pat, if you want me to explain it, or would you like to explain
it? I can explain it. You can help me out, thanks, if I get it wrong. There are three areas at the intersection of Donaldson and Johnson Ferry Road, Ashford Dunwoody Road, right there where they come together. If you are coming, if you're going from Donaldson to, if you're coming down Donaldson, going to Ashford Dunwoody Road, there, on the left-hand side of that property, we talked about this, they have the Eiffel Tower.
Mesh corners, or little five-point, little corners, a dual lane.
So you're at the right-hand lane going there. You can't see if traffic's coming down the street, I mean, not down Johnson Ferry. But if somebody thinks you can turn right on a red light and there's no, they might can see the traffic, but you can't see it. They're sitting there honking the horn at you. So the only suggestion I had that I mentioned to Bates is if you can't get the property owner to clear it, can you put a no right turn on red sign there?
My first approach to that would be that we would certainly look at addressing the safety issue with the site distance issue with the vegetation.
I think that is in the right way.
And I would anticipate that that is the solution. I recall that issue being forwarded to me by your council, and it was booted it back up to the top. I think it had come to us several days ago and came back again saying what happened. So now we're going to make sure we address it quickly.
That's one safety issue. The other safety issue is when the Ashford Dunwoody Johnson Ferry reconstruction was done there. The lane, if you're going north on Johnson Ferry, Publix is on your left and Mesh Corners is there on your right. It's now redesigned so that there are two lanes that can go straight. However, it's also a left turn lane. So if people want to turn left, but there's somebody ahead of them that's only going straight, they miss that red light and it backs up traffic.
And we are aware of that. What I can say to that is the improvements that were undertaken at that intersection, they were done within the constraints that exist. That is, we didn't work to acquire right-of-way and right-of-way road, and we worked with what we had to deal with. I believe most people would recognize that the improvements have been significant in traffic flow, but that is one issue that I would say the answer or the resolution is not perfect. A person can turn left on when the light signal light is a solid green, and there is a period of time that enables that for a few cars. But I would expect that what happens in the reality situation is somebody can expect if they're not in the right sequence of cars turning left or going straight, they're going to have to wait a cycle.
And it holds up all the cars that want to go straight. Mm-hmm. So it does create a backlog.
And it is a byproduct of the area we had to work with to make those improvements at that time.
And then the third one is far more simple. And that is, if you're going north on Johnson Ferry Road from that intersection, along going towards the hospital, there's an area just north of Publix that it just needs trimming and cutting. If you're coming out of Sunderland Circle, you can't see down that road. And then people just spinning around that curve. I know you guys are sitting down there at Kroger watching everybody, but they're still speeding when they hit that curve up there, and you're trying to turn out of Sunderland.
I've asked about that, actually.
We are approaching that initially as a code enforcement issue to see if code enforcement can engage the apartment complex to maintain that vegetation and cut it back. If they come back and say that they cannot, that's not an enforcement matter, then we will address it as a right-of-way maintenance issue.
Is that part of the apartment complex property?
The area that, if I understand where you're talking about, that is you pass by the shopping center on your right?
It's beyond that. It's around the garden.
And then you go to, is it Ashford
Homes? No. It's not there.
It's between the shopping center and the residential neighborhood.
And it's between the shopping center and Sunderland.
Right. Yes, the park.
And there's the guardrail there. And it's a wonderful sidewalk, but it's now so overgrown that people are having
just past the apartments, right?
It actually fronts the apartment property.
It's kind of a no man's land there.
It's just an area that they don't maintain the vegetation. They maintain the vegetation between their apartments and the street.
Way high now.
No, it's past the apartments. It's between the apartments and some.
Why don't we just go ahead and clear it? Not go ask him, just do it because it's a safety.
Needs a Ronnie Mayer over with a wheelie.
Send Ronnie with his tow truck and throw the stuff away.
That's where you can cut down a lot of brush.
Yeah.
All right.
There's one more site distance problem. It's right in where West Nancy Creek hits Ashford Dunwoody. She was talking about the speed of traffic, not just the trucks, the cars coming down very fast. And there's a dogwood tree, several trees that you cannot see to the right. When you're pulling up to turn, see to the left, when you're pulling up to turn right, which Marist. And if those trees could be removed or cut back, it sure would.
And you can follow with an email on that too. I appreciate it.
Could you put it on the website, just a number we could call on blind spots? Because we have several of them in Brookhaven. We get trying to make a right-hand turn. And that one on Ashford Dunwoody Road, they're supposed to drive 50 miles an hour down the hill right there.
Yes, we should have, we have a new C-Click Fix app that should handle, what's it called now?
Called City Source.
City Source.
So we could use that.
Yes, you can. But let's, you know, let's really make sure, Ben, that we, and Ben, it's new to this position. I mean, you've been here, what, 6 months as the head of the Public Works?
Not quite that long, but I've been with the city longer.
Right, you have. And Ben's a great resource. Let's just make sure we get these things addressed in time. And what are they? What paving and sidewalks are we going to be doing now, like starting in June, or is there any work going on?
The work that we've undertaken is what you might call the due diligence that we have to do in order to prepare the invitation to bid. Mm-hmm. And so for what's been identified as what's called the 2014 host funded projects, we've completed that. Right. And we'll be sending out the invitation to bid in June.
Right.
Should be able to come to the council in July to post contract for the 2014 host paving projects, and that would allow the contractors to basically complete the paving in August.
Okay. It's the 2014 projects that were funded by 2014 host that are being done now, because you don't get your host money until the end of the year. Yes, ma'am.
Has there been any discussion about extending sidewalks into the neighborhoods around Montgomery Elementary School?
Not yet, but you're starting it right now, and that's what this is for. You probably heard about it.
I mean, I advocate for the sidewalks around the schools all day long. But
it's becoming in the 8 years that I've been a parent there, and the seven more I'll be a parent there, it's becoming a huge walking, biking, kids to school, and I'd like to see that continue. But
it's also part of the bike ped plan that we've got the consultants here. They're going to be doing all of that citywide too. So mention it to them, and it'll be part of a permanent plan.
Yeah, there was. I mean, you were mentioning the interior neighborhoods. The sidewalks around the school. And there's apparently a stairway on the back side of, or the south side of Montgomery that's a problem too. That's on the school property. We've been looking at that. We addressed that with Superintendent Thurman. It's tough to get things from DeKalb. We'd love to go and do that right now because we know it's dangerous.
But the foundation would pay for it.
If they would just let you do it, right? Sometimes that foundation
has... But it doesn't work that way.
Right, well, sometimes y'all do work that, and then you ask for forgiveness later.
Maybe when we get our new principal, we can do it that way.
Did you have anything else you wanted to ask?
I wanted to mention a couple of initiatives we're undertaking to address some stormwater issues real quick. We have selected a contractor that is underway, a consultant that is looking at improving drainage behavior on Osborne Road, at the south end of Osborne Road, coming from Peachtree as you go down the hill to the north. They actually presented to us some concepts that they're looking at that would address what you might call as localized drainage, surface drainage issues on the surface of Osborne Road. We're also getting ready to select a consultant that's going to do the same thing for some existing drainage issues on the surface of South Bambi, because even when you have just a normal gully washer, there's some significant flooding on the surface of South Bambi that impacts the houses on both sides of the street. And that's the kind of effort that we also undertake that are smaller than the big plans that the consultants have presented today. Just to give you a couple of examples. If you are in the community and you know of other areas that you think would warrant us to look at, please let us know.
All right. Any more paper sidewalk questions? All right. Thank you, Bennett. Quickly, Carl's the last presenter, and then we're just going to end it after Carl because we are way over time. I apologize, Father Harry.
Good afternoon. I'm Carl Stevens. I'm the finance director for the city of Brookhaven. We're responsible for finance, accounting, procurement. I guess generally we're responsible for making sure all of these pieces of the puzzle fit together in some manner or form that we can pay for them. In December, city council passed a budget of approximately $20.5 million. And that budget included an estimated millage rate of 2.795. We're in the midst of receiving preliminary digest from the DeKalb County Tax Commission Assessor's Office. And in the month of June, we will have public hearings regarding setting the millage rate for that budget. We need to understand that in that budget, we estimated property tax revenues of $6.5 million. That's a little less than one third of the general fund's operating budget of $20.5 million. The ads will begin running this Sunday in the AJC. By law, we're required to have three public hearings. We're trying to schedule those public hearings so they'll be on the commission, the date that the commission would the council would typically meet. We'll have a meeting on June the 9th at 7 p.m. That's the regular time that the city council will be meeting. But we'll also have a special call meeting on the morning on June 16th at 10:30 a.m. And we'll have an afternoon meeting at starting at 6 o'clock. State law requires for public notice that we provide and have a public hearing between the hours of 6 and 7 p.m. to discuss the millage rate that we're about to establish for the city of Brookhaven. Again, it's always been a pleasure. I know I'm last, and I'm not going to take any more than 90 seconds. It's been a pleasure to work for everybody that's been here with the board, this council, and with the department heads for the little while that I've been here. I've enjoyed the challenge. They keep me hopping. They get to see they got a lot of ideas and a lot of things going. A lot of times I feel like the Wizard of Oz and the man behind the curtain. I mean, how do we put all this together? But prayerfully, we're going to work through it, and they've all been a great working body. And again, we're here to serve you, and the Department of Finance is here to represent these fine people here, other departments. I always tell them, I say, I'm not a police officer, I'm not a city council person, I'm a bean counter. You tell me what you want to do, I give you some options on how to do it, but you decide how to do it. That's my approach. Get my office always open to any of the concerns that you may have regarding the finances of the city of Brookhaven.
Yeah, we did. Listen, thank you.
We'll stick around for questions after.
Yeah, yeah, if the council people want to make some public statements, I've been waiting 2.5 hours.
I'd like to have a beer.
Okay. You want to do 30 seconds?
30 seconds.
Well, I would like to really offer a special thanks again to Marist, as the police chief said. They have been so generous to the city of Brookhaven and been such a great community of partner for us. And Father Howard, thank you again for opening up your doors and inviting us in. It's actually gotten cooler, but the hospitality here is always great. And you know, if you haven't been over here to see the new facility and the work that they've done on the Cross Creek campus, it's really, I like to bring people over to show them. It's really state-of-the-art, environmentally sensitive engineering that, you know, you may see an asphalt parking lot out there, but it's porous, and there's a retention pond underneath. So some of the measures, there's bioswales back there. They've really taken some measures that state-of-the-art to actually prevent flooding and better filter the water and better be good caretakers of Nancy Creek. So I thank you for that. I just want to thank you all for coming out. If I'm District 1, so if you live in this area where we are here, north of Windsor Parkway all the way to 285 is where District 1 is, I send out a somewhat regular email when I can. So if you're not on my list, come by and give me your email address so I can add you to it. If you haven't signed up for the City eBlast, please do. As you can see, there's a lot going on in Brookhaven, and a lot of great things. It's hard to keep track of it all, I know. It's hard to be plugged in. It's hard to be at all the meetings. It's hard for us to be at all the meetings. So thank you for your input. I think we all really try hard to read every email.
I answer every phone call. So we do try to connect with our people and hear a wide range of voices. And we're often aware that at meetings we don't hear the full range of voices. So we hear you in a lot of different forums, and we appreciate that. So just keep talking to us. It's all about communication. We're all in this together, and really, let's go forward and just continue to build a great city.
I'll go very quickly. Two big issues that I want to touch on. One is the Brookhaven MARTA station development. MARTA is put out to bid the redevelopment of the Brookhaven MARTA station. It's 12 acres, I believe, both the front, which is along Peachtree Road, and the backside, which backs up to Apple Valley. They've put that out to bid to seven developers who qualified under their process, and MARTA, I think, closes that RFP bidding process tomorrow. Then they have about 45 or 60 days to make a decision on who their one developer is. Now, once that one developer is chosen, they'll go through interaction with our city to come up with a plan. And that plan will have to go through rezoning. And I expect that rezoning application probably to come in by the end of this year. So the end of 2015, we'll get a rezoning hearing for MARTA as the property owner, redeveloping their property. And we'll have to make a decision on that. Then that construction would probably start in 2016, and it's a large enough project that probably would be phased. In order to affect communication process about the concerns that the citizens of Brookhaven have, we created the MARTA Citizens Review Board. It's got 14 members of citizens from all around the city of Brookhaven, from each of the council districts and each of the surrounding neighborhoods surrounding the MARTA station, plus members of the BPCA and our development authority. But it's meant to communicate to these developers and be engaged with MARTA and the developers about what the concerns are, and make sure that as they design their plans, that they're aware of what our concerns are, so that the time we get up to rezoning, hopefully they will have heard those concerns and come forward with a plan that the citizens actually want to see have happen. The second thing I want to touch on is that we have resubmitted for Brookhaven Innovation Academy. It's an independent state-sponsored charter school. It's publicly funded, so it'll be tuition-free. We're starting off K-6, and we'll grow, hopefully, K-12, but our application's only K-8 for our first application. That'll be decided by the State Charter Commission in August or September of this year. If it's approved, it would then be open August 2016. But it's meant to address two big concerns we have here in Brookhaven. One is that we want to have a quality education option for all of the citizens in the city of Brookhaven. And we have some areas with top-tier public school options. We have some areas where they'd like to have a second option. We want to make sure that everybody has an equal opportunity to top-notch. And in Brookhaven Innovations Academy, it's a 21st century learning environment focused on STEAM, project-based learning, teaching for jobs of the future. We hope we get that approved, and if it's approved, then next year we'll have a new school option for all the citizens of the city of Brookhaven. If you want to find out more information, you go to brookhaven.education. You can sign up there. It's not a direct function of the city. It's an independent 501c3, but it is important for our citizens' needs here.
Thanks, Bates. First, I want to do an announcement that on July 17 and 18, there's a special event taking place at Woodward Elementary School. If you are not aware, they won a very special award from the Georgia United Credit Union Marketing Department, where they're going to be given umpteen dollars, and the number hasn't been set, but it's been referred to me, it could be between $50,000 and $100,000 or more for refurbishing the exterior and some interior of that school, which has been significantly underfunded ever since it's been there. So this is a much welcomed facelift. We're looking for volunteers to come out and help. An announcement went out to the city of Brookhaven. So if you'd like to join in on that, please. It's an opportunity for us to really show our commitment to the educational process and the educational system we have here in Brookhaven. Now I want to offer two comments. I can sit here and talk about all the good things the city has done. I mean, we've had a lot of presentations here tonight. Make a couple of quick comments, especially about the police chief. I don't think you folks realize the reputation he has outside of Brookhaven with the FBI and Homeland Security. I mean, this guy is well respected in the community, and it comes back to us in many ways. But there's a lot of other things that go on too in what we do as a city. You've heard him here tonight. I mean, Bates, thank you very much for the leadership that you've given in the educational part of this. We're going to be probably the first city in the state to do a city-sponsored state charter school. I mean, this is record-breaking things that we're trying to do here in the city. Rebecca, your leadership and what you did with just the food trucks, which has become a standard now, your Cherry Blossom Festival, and a lot of other things that the traffic improvements, I mean, your addition to council is phenomenal. Have we done a lot of good things? Absolutely. Are we doing everything perfectly? Absolutely not. And we know it. And that's why we have these sessions, and these sessions are really important. So we are listening, believe me. We appreciate your emails, they're very important. Send us your phone calls. I mean, I think every one of us has our cell phone listed on our cards. And for those of you that know me, you call me my cell phone, I answer, and I'll call you back, usually within 24 hours. But as a city, you know, when we first took this position, when we first all went out, and yeah, you know, we all, I openly admitted that this is gonna be an on-the-job learning process. None of us had held these positions before. I think in 2.5 years, we've come fairly seasoned. We're not where we're, I think we're at our best, but we definitely work in that direction. And I think the efforts that we put forth have created a reputation for this city that is well known throughout the state. I want to tell you right now, I spend a fair amount of time looking at regional perspective, getting involved with things that are not always just right inside Brookhaven, because we're having a big impact on what happens in the surrounding area around us. Our reputation out there is, we're held in high esteem. So I'm really, really proud of that. And you may not hear that because I think we're only here in Brookhaven, but that's a fact, and it is happening. But nothing stays the same. And the only thing that's constant is change. And I know the mayor's gonna have some closing comments, and we're gonna be looking at facing some changes here in the city of Brookhaven. So I wanted to just take a moment so you're aware what we as council will be faced with and how we will plan to use the charter, which is the document that has been very wisely put together by our legislators to enable the continuation and the strength of the city. Should and when the mayor leave his office, at that time, at the next announced city council meeting, the mayor pro tem, which will be Rebecca, will take over the meeting. And the first call of duty will be for a selection by city council of a new mayor. And that could be anybody. Once that, could be a council member, could be an outside person. Once that person is chosen, if it is a council person, that council person will be required to resign from that position and assume the full responsibilities of mayor. Be sworn in immediately. Upon that point, the new mayor will have the right to select a replacement council person only if there is less than 6 months time period left in that position. So that means if Bates or Rebecca were to be chosen, they have 6 months left before their election comes up in November. If it's John or myself, we have more than 6 months, it would have to go for a November election. So if a person is selected with less than 6 months left on that term, the mayor has, at that point, the right to appoint a replacement person, a replacement council member, per the approval of council. And that's it. That's what the charter says. So for you folks out there that are interested in what the process is, I'm not sure many of you knew it. But I wanted to take this opportunity here at this forum to bring that to your attention and to just say we are a strong city. And regardless of the people that are sitting here and setting policy, the unit is stronger than any one individual. And it's designed to, the process is designed so that we can continue in a very strong manner. And I'm very encouraged that we will. So with that said, I want to thank you all for coming. This is a very important moment that we need to be doing. We like to do this regularly, 4 times a year, I think is the goal. Five? great, that's even better. And I'm going to be around. If you have any questions, I'd like to chat with you about the elementary schools, if you don't mind. And I'm going to turn this over to the mayor for closing comments.
Again, thank you all for coming. And thank you, Joe and Bates and Rebecca and staff and all the citizens here. It's been a distinct honor of mine to serve as your mayor for the last 2.5 years. As you might know, the first terms of anybody in a new city are always staggered or shortened from what they would be in regular city operations. So Joe's first term was a year, now he's got a 4-year term. Rebecca and myself and me and Bates, our terms expired this year. So in regards to what Joe's succession plan was talking about, anybody appointed to anything in the next month or so will have to stand for election in November so that you get your choice at the ballot box then as well. But yes, many of you know this, but I will be resigning next week as your mayor. This will be my last town hall as the mayor of Brookhaven. And I'll be running for another office vacated by State Representative Mike Jacobs. I think that my experience as mayor has been made so wonderful by the fact that, you know, I've held over 100 Mondays with the mayor. I'm going to have another one Monday, Mondays with the mayor, my last one, where I've gotten perspective. I meet 5 or 6 citizens, 7, 8, 9 sometimes on a Monday. And I get to hear from you directly, the citizens of Brookhaven, about issues you care about and things you want done. And they've been so beneficial. So I hope that tradition continues with whoever the next mayor is. We've also done dozens of walks with the mayor. I know there's some folks here who have participated in those with me. Those have been great for your elected official to go into your neighborhood on your terms so that you can walk around your neighborhood and point out the things that you want to see done or issues that you might have. So, you know, those things, the town halls, we have more town halls than any other city that, you know, when we go to these the municipal conventions, they always say, why do you have so many town halls? I couldn't handle that. That's ridiculous. It's what we were founded upon. But we started the city, didn't we, Rebecca and Lindley and everybody? We started the city through town hall meetings. That's how it worked, is you get together as a group, you hash out your differences, you argue, you praise, you criticize, and you give your ideas. So building community through town halls, through the festivals that we have, through the food trucks, through Mondays with the mayor, through walks with the mayor, through the Brookhaven 101, all these things, we do more than any other city in the metro area when it comes to engaging our citizens on specific issues. We always need to do more of that. We need to hear from you more emails, more phone calls. We get, you know, dozens and dozens of emails about all kinds of issues. We got plenty on the Oak Forest issue. We didn't get as many on the Ashford Green this time that I thought we would, but it was evident when the folks came, there were some concerns about it as well. But again, I enjoyed being your mayor. This public service is what was fulfilling to me. We don't do it for the salary. You know, they make $12,000 a year and the mayor makes $16,000 a year. It's not about...
You make more than us?
Yeah. It's not about that. But what the satisfaction I get from being the mayor of Brookhaven is when I see the tax dollars that were previously, in many instances, wasted, taken and applied to things that I know that the citizens of Brookhaven want, which is paving, which is police, which are world-class police department, which is sidewalks, which are park improvements, stormwater, the 911, we have our own fire marshal. That is what motivates me and motivates all of us when we see the application of resources, your resources, to ideas. And many times they're your ideas. And that's what this city is all about. We've had our bumps in the road, but it's on balance. To have cut taxes twice, to have a $4 million reserve, and have the police department we have, the paving, and all the work that we've done, it's been a great win for the citizens of Brookhaven to have this city. And I think most people agree with that. They come up and tell me all the time, to grab me by the arm at the grocery store. I know you don't hear it enough, but I just want to thank you. Y'all are doing so many great things. And I tell them, you know what, I do hear it. So I appreciate you telling me that. So we have the best, most intelligent, educated citizens in the metro area. We have the best city council. We've got some of the best staff. And I just want to thank you, the citizens of Brookhaven, for making Brookhaven what it is. Keep staying engaged. Protect your neighborhoods. Protect your city. Ask for more. Make sure that you get your taxpayers' dollars worth. And I'll see you soon. I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying right here in Brookhaven. So thank you so much for coming. And thank you for being here.
Where are you going?
Yeah.
congratulations.